I could be someone famous, I think I would like to be Martin Brodeur. He always been my idol since I'm a little boy, so he seems to be a real nice guy and with a great talent too in hockey, so I think I would like to be him. My most memorable moment was I think at the World Junior when I played, when we beat the USA in the semis, I think just to be on the ice at that time and with the crowd was sold out too, I think that was something very nice.
What a year for Marc-Andre Fleury. His Canadian team, though, fell to Russia in the gold medal game at the World Junior Hockey Championship. Will we see a Russian player selected with the fourth overall selection by Doug McLean of the Columbus Blue Jackets? He's our president, GM, and coach.
On behalf of the Blue Jackets organization, we'd like to thank the Nashville Predators fans for such a warm reception. We'd like to thank Craig Leopold, Jack Diller, David Poile, and the entire organization for such a great week and such a great job hosting the draft. And to the entire organization and to the fans in Nashville, we really appreciate it. I'd like to congratulate the New Jersey Devils for a great Stanley Cup run. And the Anaheim Mighty Ducks for such an unbelievable playoff run. To the fans in Columbus at our draft party and to the 750,000 fans that watched the Blue Jackets play this year in Columbus, thank you. And for our first selection from hockey club CSKA Moscow, Nikolai Zhirdev.
All right, Bob, you called him the poor man's Ilya Kovalchuk. That's not an insult.
Not at all. Great speed, great skill, great goal-scoring ability, quick hands, quick feet. A little bit temperamental, has a little bit of a temperament where he sometimes doesn't use the players on the ice as well as some scouts would like. All those things, though, go by the wayside. And I should point out, they were said about Ilya Kovalchuk, and they were even said about Marian Gaborik in his draft year. But that's what the Columbus Blue Jackets feel as though they have, is a player who can fit into that same sort of mold as a Kovalchuk, as a Gaborik, a European high-skill, high-speed guy, Pierre.
And he has all those intangibles, Bob. The only thing that would worry me about his evolving ability as an NHL player is sometimes he doesn't like to get into the traffic area. Saw that at the World Junior Hockey Championship, and that's going to be the question mark until he gets over to North America and improves himself physically.
Well, interesting, too, that, you know, most draft-eligible players don't make an impact at the World Junior, but Alexander Ovechkin from Russia, who's up for next year's draft, was so dominant that Zhirdev might have looked poor by comparison.
But you know what? That was the difference, though. Ovechkin wasn't afraid to get into those traffic or trouble areas, and this guy definitely pulled up a little bit. So that'd be the only question mark I'd have on him.
He didn't have a great World Junior, but he did play well over the course of the year, and I know that Don Boyd, the gentleman on the extreme left, is extremely high on Zhirdev for the entire year, and I'm sure that the Columbus Blue Jackets won't be saying lip service after the draft when they suggest that they had Nikolai Zhirdev rated number one, and I can assure you this, they weren't the only team in the National Hockey League that believes Nikolai Zhirdev was the number one talent. Of the four players that have been taken so far, each of the four received some consideration from the scouts as the number one overall pick. So it's spread across the board. Stahl was probably the consensus choice, but Fleury, Horton, and Zhirdev all received consideration from scouts as the best prospect available in this draft.
Well, you got Rick Nash, and now you got Zhirdev as well, so firepower shouldn't be a problem, you'd think, for a team that really struggled to score goals last season. Let's go back to Dave Strader.
All right, Doug McLean, you made the announcement. You told me about an hour ago this is the way it looked like it was going to happen. You feel you got the best player in the draft?
Yeah, we feel he was number one on our list, to be quite honest. Offensive star potential, great skater, great speed. An unbelievable bookend for Rick Nash.
With all the titles you hold, you get to announce him as the draft pick, decide how much money he's going to make, and how much playing time he gets. He'd better be good to you.
I'm hoping I'm going to be able to ride his coattails for a few years. If I can ride Nash, Klesla, and Mark Denise coattails, I'll be all right for a while.
Does he seem like a kid that can step right in, or is that training camp decide that?
Yeah, we're going to really look at that. He's a young kid. He's just turned 18, and we're going to really have a good look at that and see what his development is. He's going to play for, if he doesn't play for us, he's going to play for Tikhonov in Russia, so he's going to get pretty good coaching.
All right, Doug, thanks very much. Congratulations, Gord.
Yeah, Doug McLean, busy week for him. He attended the governor's meetings, the manager's meetings, and the coach's meeting. And of course, last year they drafted Rick Nash. He walked right into the NHL and made an impact, guys.
Rick Nash, size, strength, speed, everything you would want in a number one overall pick, and he's going to be a star in the National Hockey League.
You know, the big thing that Doug McClain has to address is the fact that Ray Whitney might be moving on, and he's one of their best pure offensive players, so obviously Rick Nash can be very important. And also you look at the fact that now Zverev has a chance to really evolve.
Well, now we're going to see another goal scorer go here. Expect Thomas Vanek, the big forward, Austrian forward from the University of Minnesota. Buffalo needs goal scoring. He's their man.
Good afternoon. On behalf of the Buffalo Sabre Hockey Organization, we'd like to extend a thank you to the city of Nashville and to Craig Leopold for your tremendous hospitality. To the people of Buffalo and Western New York, I want to assure them today that this Buffalo Sabre organization is working very, very hard to bring great hockey to Western New York. And now we'll make our announcement.
Buffalo selects with the fifth overall pick from the University of Minnesota, Thomas Vanek.
Don Luce makes the pick after Thomas Golisano, the new owner, speaks for the Buffalo Sabres. Thomas Vanek, Bob, you called it. Austrian born, his dad played in the Austrian League. Came over to North America, actually played Tier 2 hockey in Canada, and then finds his way to the University of Minnesota where he electrified people.
He really did, and I think this is one of the few players that's actually selected in the first five picks that could play in the NHL this coming season. Thomas Vanek is an unbelievable pick because he doesn't slow down. When that puck gets on his stick, he explodes and goes to the net, and his one-on-one ability, as you see right there, is second to none. This guy is ready to play in the NHL right now.
Best pure goal scorer available in this draft. 31 goals in a freshman, a dominant freshman season, leading the University of Minnesota Golden Gophers to their second consecutive NCAA crown. Of the 31 goals he scored, 17 were scored in the third period or overtime. This guy's a money player. Now, on his bad days, he's been compared to Pavel Brendl, the guy who didn't work out so far anyways, as a number four overall pick to the New York Rangers. He's been with three National Hockey League teams. On his good days, though, Vanek looks an awful lot like Marian Hossa. He had many more good days than he did bad days. And keep in mind, the Buffalo Sabre fans are familiar with this guy. The Frozen Four, the championship of the NCAA, was held at the HSBC Arena in Buffalo this year. The fans got to see him firsthand. He electrified everybody with a scoring ability, especially in an overtime game, to send the Gophers to the championship game. This guy is a pure goal scorer, and the highest ever Austrian chose him in the National Hockey League.
You know, Bob, the other part of it is, and the reason why I don't think he'll be like Pavel Brendl in terms of being a successful NHLer is the fact that he came over, as Gord said, he played Tier 2 hockey in Alberta, went to Rochester, New York. They couldn't find a schooling program for him. Went and did his charge in the USHL, which is not an easy league to play in. This guy desperately wanted to make it here in North America, a little bit different from Pavel Brendl. I think Thomas Vanek will be a huge impact player for Buffalo.
And you're going to see more and more of this, European players who have come over as teenagers to play, and Vanek, of course, goes to college, and the Buffalo Sabres first-round picks include Keith Ballard last year, a player they're very, very high on.
And he's one of his teammates at the University of Minnesota.
Let's go back down to Dave Strader.
All right, Darcy Regier, general manager of the Buffalo Sabres. You guys have had a lot of things on your plate with the ownership situation. Now that everything's settled, you can look forward.
We can, and we're delighted with this pick. It's a great way to move forward.
We don't always know if young kids are ready to step in, but the guys are saying Thomas Vanek may be a guy that can step in and play this season.
Well, that's something we're going to take a look at, but I think he is down the road towards the start of his pro career, so we'll just have to wait and see.
He scores goals, he scores big goals, and he's a winner with a couple of NCAA championships. What was the one characteristic that brought him to your number one selection?
Well, I think he's a goal scorer, and he scores big goals. So many of his goals were in crucial situations, and that's something we need in our community and with our hockey club.
All right, Darcy, congratulations.
Thank you, Dave.
Guys?
All right, Thomas Vanek is the fifth player selected. And Mr. McKenzie, you are 5 for 5 with your top five. But now we move to the number six spot, the San Jose Sharks, and their new general manager, Doug Wilson, who takes over for his friend Dean Lombardi, who was let go late last season. The Sharks, who appeared to be the model NHL franchise at this time last year, they were on the track for great things. And of course, the whole season went wrong. They moved Owen Nolan. They've got two first-round picks, but this one is their own.
They're interested in a defenseman here, either Suter, Ryan Suter, or Braden Coburn. Probably will be Suter, unless they got an inducement from one of the teams behind them, Nashville or Atlanta, to take somebody other than Suter. So we'll see what happens here.
I talked to Ryan Suter yesterday, and he said he had as many as 5 different interviews with the San Jose Sharks. Remember, his uncle played there.
I'd like to thank the fans in San Jose for the great support over the years and the city of Nashville for great hospitality. With the first selection, San Jose selects Milan Mikulic from Cheska Bojevic.
Tim Burke. Tim Burke, the chief scout for the San Jose Sharks, and they go not necessarily off the board because Milan Mihailik was a player that some people thought a year ago could have been the first pick of the draft.
There was a chance that Milan Mihailik was going to have his stock plummet in this draft, even though he was considered by many to be a top five pick. I'll be very interested to find out whether the San Jose Sharks received some sort of inducement from the Nashville Predators or the Atlanta Thrashers picking at 7 and 8 to take somebody other than a defenseman. The San Jose Sharks were supposed to start a run of defensemen at number 6, 7, and 8 with both Nashville and Atlanta interested in guys like Ryan Suter, Braden Coburn, and Dion Phaneuf. So this is a bit of a curveball that a lot of us didn't see coming, and I'll be interested to see whether there was any inducement to take somebody other than a defenseman with that pick. Mikhailik is the guy who's most ready to play in the National Hockey League in this draft. Most scouts would agree on that. A solid two-way player, the knock on him, limited offensive upside.
And that's exactly where I was going to go, Bob. I'm not sure he's the most pure offensive player. We see him scoring some nice highlight reel goals in that situation, but that's at the World Junior Hockey Championship. I just wonder if he's going to be able to produce points at the rate that a lot of team people think he is right now.
Interesting departure for the San Jose Sharks as well. Remember in the mid-90s, they took almost Finns in the 95 draft, and they were a very European-heavy organization for the first part of their history, but they really gravitated towards North American players. Canadians and U.S. college players were the story of their recent draft picks, but Milan Mihailik, the forward from the Czech Republic, is the first of two first-round picks the San Jose Sharks have in this draft. Doug Wilson on the left, the new GM of the Sharks.
What that probably means is that the run on defenseman we expected to start at number 6 overall with San Jose will likely now start at number 7 with Nashville, who are really really big on Braden Coburn of the Portland Winterhawks, and Ryan Suter, who's at the U.S. National Under-18 team, will be going to University of Wisconsin next year.
Well, when you talk about a team that has a blueprint, San Jose really believed in drafting and development. Brad Stewart, of course, in 1998. Jeff Gilson in 1999. And get ready for a huge roar here. They have just announced that the Nashville Predators have the next selection, and we should pay tribute to the people of Nashville. This is an enormous crowd that is really putting on quite a show. And Dave Strader, if you can hear me down there, let's send it down to you.
Yeah, a little difficult to hear because Nashville's getting ready to pick, but new general manager Doug Wilson and Bob McKenzie upstairs was 5 for 5 and picking who the selections are going to be until you guys stepped up. He thought it might be Coburn or Suter, one of the defensemen. Was there any kind of a deal to stay away from those guys with the selection you made?
No, there was no deal. We're very pleasantly surprised. I mean, he was a player that we've been targeting for quite a while. We're very fortunate that we have a lot of depth in nets, a lot of depth in the back end. He fits in very well with our hockey team. Believe me, we're excited.
Doug, you mentioned getting this post so late. You were a month behind a lot of the other guys. You have to rely an awful lot on your scouting staff and the people that have been watching these kids all year long.
Well, we had continuity with our scouting staff, and not only Timmy Burke and the amateurs, but John Ferguson on the pro side. And I just basically had to stay out of their way. We looked at some other options, but for this player to fall to us, we're very excited.
All right, congratulations, Doug. Back up to Gord.
Doug Wilson, the former captain of the San Jose Sharks. Nashville's next, but our live coverage continues after this.
For the best protection against water damage, one name says it all. Thompson's Water Seal, Wood Protector Plus Waterproofer for the highest level of water protection guarantee. Thompson's Water Seal and New Advance, the most powerful protection against water damage.
How do you keep a car from ending up like this? Try Armor. Armor All Protected. It does more than clean and shine. It protects.
This summer, ESPN2 invites you to the hottest block party around. Kick it on Friday nights with host Mos Def for sports and more. ESPN2's Block Party, presented by Dodge. Friday nights at 7, all summer long.
Latin Fury, live from Puerto Rico. Undefeated sensation Miguel Cotto. WBO junior middleweight champion Daniel Santos. And WBA flyweight champion Eric Morrell. Contact your pay-per-view provider to order.
Hey, I know you're frustrated with slow dial-up internet. And if you think you can't get high-speed internet, think again. Now there's a new high-speed internet solution by Satellite. and you can get it right now. Directway is the high-speed internet that works anywhere in the continental U.S., just as long as you have a clear view of the southern sky. Interested? Thought so. Now grab your remote, flip to channel 227, and find out about the new high-speed internet option available right now. Channel 227. I'll meet you there.
YouTube it every day, but you've never seen it done like this. It's extreme everyday driving. See stop and go driving. Bumper to bumper bedlam.
Lay on the horn, it's gridlock, baby.
Ramp up the engine with a damn
This may not look extreme to you, but it is to your engine. Fram Tough Guard oil filters, tough enough to handle the extremes of everyday driving. Fram, do you drive tough?
It's gonna be awesome.
Huge partisan crowd here in Nashville, one of the biggest gatherings we've seen here at the draft, and they erupt now as GM David Poile makes the Predators selection.
Predators fans, you've been great for 5 years, and once again, you've proved yourself again today. It's now our turn to prove to you that we're going to be an up-and-coming and very competitive team in the National Hockey League very, very soon. Today, we take another big step in that direction. And we hope today, with this next pick and the other picks that we make in this draft, that this becomes a defining moment in our franchise history. We are very proud to announce and select as our first pick in today's draft from the U.S. Development League and the University of Wisconsin, Ryan Suter.
The nephew of Gary Suter, you see his dad, Bob, there playing at the University of Wisconsin as well. Ryan Suter, Pierre. You hate to say he's like his uncle, but if you saw Gary Suter play in the NHL, you've seen Ryan.
Oh, no, what? You got to go with that, Corey. That's a great point by you. This is an outstanding selection for Nashville. He's a well-spoken guy. He's a champion human being. He's done it short as a player. The biggest thing you like about him, there's a consistency to his game, and it's just overwhelming the noise here. But he's physical. He can handle a puck. He can pass tape to tape. He loves to jump into the rush. He's a stalwart defensive presence. He is not intimidated by a big moment. He can run a power play. I can't say enough good things about Ryan Suter, and he's such a well-conditioned guy. This is a great selection for Nashville.
And the National Hockey League testing, Ryan Suter was off the scale, excellent in every physical area. The conditioning test done by NHL Central Scouting.
Mentioned his dad, Bob. He also played on the 1980 U.S. Olympic team. Remember that Miracle on Ice squad. So bloodlines mean something in hockey.
And right, you know, you and I were at the World Junior this year, and we had a chance to visit with Ryan Suter right after the USA beat Finland. And when we were visiting with him, he was the last guy to leave the dressing room. What he was doing was he was helping the equipment managers pack the bags, pack the stick bag, make sure all the bags are on the truck. This is a championship guy, and it will definitely make a difference in Nashville.
Well, they're building from the goal out, and they hope that this building block on defense, you know, Nashville's shown signs, but as David Poile alluded to in his talk to the people, they're waiting for the breakthrough here, and perhaps Ryan Suter can provide it pretty soon. Gary Suter was a guy picked very late by the Calgary Flames in 1984, played over 1,000 games in the National Hockey League. And it was really something to see Ryan drafted here so high in the first round. Gary Suter, I know, was a big part of his career, trying to help him along the way, and his dad, too.
And you're right, Gord, a lot of similarities. Mobile, puck handler, quarterback of power play. Ryan, as Pierre pointed out, also has a lot of physical capabilities, has some real jam. He's going to start a run on defenseman here. It'll be interesting. Braden Coburn most likely to go next to the Atlanta Thrashers. And with more, here's Dave Strader.
All right, Ryan Suter with the Nashville Predators now, and it's got to be exciting to be selected here in this building. You know you got the fan support.
Oh, yeah. You know, walking in here, you didn't know what to expect, really, and seeing all these people, it's a great thing.
Obviously, the bloodline's a big story with you and your father, Bob, your uncle, Gary, and the guys were saying you play more like your uncle, but it's got to be a proud moment for your family to continue this tradition.
My dad's so happy for me, and that's what he said. He said, there you go, when they called me up, so. It's truly an honor.
All right, Ryan, congratulations.
Thank you.
Gordon.
Now does this start the run? These were the 3D, Bob, that you were talking about. Ryan Suter, Braden Coburn, and Dion Phaneuf. And Coburn and Phaneuf are a couple of kids that play good old-fashioned hockey the way we like.
Look at the size of these guys. Coburn, 6'5", 205. Phaneuf, 6'2", 205. Of the two, Phaneuf's a little bit smaller, but he plays more physical. Coburn's more of an all-around package, and the expectation is that the Atlanta Thrashers general manager Don Waddell will go up there along with the scouting staff Danny Marr and announce Braden Coburn as the guy.
Well, when you got Ilya Komolchuk scoring up front, you might need some help on defense because he ain't coming back. So.
Well, this is what the Thrashers wanted for a while, Pierre, some help on the blue line.
There's no question. You're talking about Danny Heatley and Ilya Komolchuk, and now you've got Kerry Laitinen coming in goal. You always want to build down the middle. You want to build with some offense, and now they've got the offense, they've got the goaltender. Now they're going to get the stopper on defense. This is great luck for Atlanta getting this position.
Phaneuf might be an attractive possibility here as well, but everybody seems to have Coburn a little ahead of Phaneuf, and I assume that the Atlanta Thrashers do as well.
GM Don Waddell, who was a defenseman in his day, will make the pick for the Thrashers.
The Atlanta Thrashers would like to thank the Nashville Predators organization, the great fans of the city of Nashville, for hosting the 2003 entry draft. We'd like to congratulate the New Jersey Devils on winning the Stanley Cup. And we'd like to welcome all our great fans in Atlanta watching this draft party back in Atlanta. With the 8th pick in the 2003 entry draft, the Atlanta Thrashers are proud to pick from the Portland Winterhawks of the Western Hockey League, Braden Coburn.
Braden Coburn from Shaunavon, Saskatchewan. And this is a guy that at the World Junior Camp really impressed the coaches. He did not make the Canadian National Junior Team, but they felt he was very close. 6 foot five, 205 pounds, and he is a big time thumper.
He really is, and the thing that I like about him, I think he's a poor man's Chris Pronger, and that's not any disrespect towards Braden Coburn. Chris Pronger just has a little bit better puck handling ability, but this guy is very smart and he can skate extremely well for a big lanky player, Bob.
From Shaunavon, Saskatchewan, I'll tell you right now, this selection by the Atlanta Thrashers and the picking of the San Jose Sharks taking Milan Mihailuk, number 6, makes the Calgary Flames the next team picking real excited. We'll talk about Coburn in just a moment. But Daryl Sutter loves Dion Phaneuf, the big banging defenseman of the Western Hockey League, and now there's an excellent chance they'll get him. But the Atlanta Thrashers love Coburn, and he brings an all-around presence to the game. This guy makes an excellent first pass. He's an excellent skater. He reads the play well on defense. He reads the play well on offense. He's not an offensive defenseman in terms of putting up big numbers. He's not a bone-crushing guy that's going to run around all over the ice like Phaneuf and take guys with the big Scott Stevens type hit in the middle. But his one-on-one play is exceptional, considered by many to be the best all-around defenseman available in this draft.
You know, the other part of his learning curve will be realized this year when he gets a chance to play for Team Canada at the World Junior Hockey Championships in Finland, and that is an unbelievable growth spurt for a player like that, having a chance to play at that level of competition. This is great news for the Atlanta Thrashers.
And the Atlanta Thrashers, they've got the firepower up front, as we mentioned, when you've got Ilya Komolchuk, and of course you've got Danny Heatley alongside him. And you know, you talk about building your team. Kerry Lehtinen in goal is a guy who has electrified people the last couple years internationally. So now you've got the goaltender, you've got the forwards, the defenseman, and now Daryl Sutter, the GM of the Calgary Flames, will get set to make his pick. We'll have that for you when we come back to Nashville after this.
All right, it's between you guys.
Best bartender gets the job.
After you.
Oh boy.
Yeah. The bad blue, please.
I've got this one. Canada's finest.
Thanks.
Look up, see blue, Labatt Blue.
Is it hot in here, or is it just him?
If the last thing you want to do is get married,
welcome to the family. You can call me Pussy now.
Was he?
You know, like a cat.
Then bring home Just Married on DVD for your girlfriend. Just Married. Own the DVD or rip the video today.
Hi, Mom. It's Pee-wee.
Say hi to Pussy for me.
Taco Bell's new chicken enchilada bowl. Grilled all white meat chicken, seasoned rice and beans, a traditional slow simmered sauce, and three cheeses all melting together. To experience enchilada nirvana, you've got to think outside the bun.
The herd is constantly migrating, driven by instinct to where the signal is weakest. The antelope live as they always have, man's unwitting accomplice in making coast-to-coast walkie-talkies possible, bred to instantly relay radio signals as they frolic, graze, and even mate across the vast reaches of America.
No, that's not how we did it. Introducing Nextel's coast-to-coast walkie-talkie. Now that's a walkie-talkie.
ESPN's coverage of the 57th Annual College World Series from Omaha, Nebraska continues tonight with Game 1 of the inaugural Championship Series. Stanford and Rice face off in the best of three championship live at 7 Eastern. The College World Series on ESPN is also available on ESPN HD. Call 1-800-DIRECTV or your cable operator to get ESPN HD. For more information, log on to ESPN.com.
Back here in Nashville, country music fan Daryl Sutter is the new GM of the Calgary Flames, and he made it very clear when he took over that his team would be looking to Canadian players when they drafted. Well, there's one available, Dion Phaneuf, and Daryl Sutter might know him a little because he's coached by his brother Brent with the Red Deer Rebels. And who's going to make the pick for the Calgary Flames? That's the big question. Todd Button is their chief scout on the right, brother of Craig Button, who was recently released as a general manager, replaced by Daryl Sutter. Here's Todd with the pick.
The Calgary Flames would like to thank the great city of Nashville for all their hospitality this week. We'd also like to thank all our loyal and supportive fans back in Calgary. With our first selection, we select from the Red Deer Rebels, Dion Phaneuf.
Well, if there was ever a Daryl Sutter type player, this guy is it.
You know what, I just think that you look at Dion Phaneuf and the jam that he brings and the way he just body slams people on the ice. He's not afraid to drop the mittens and get after people. He's a defensive presence, and you think about the fact that he just extended Robin Regier, who's a stalwart defenseman, for 5 years. He'll probably be a tandem player with Dion Phaneuf. But it's all about physical presence, Bob, with Dion Phaneuf. He reads the rush well. He's real smart in identifying people and going right after them. And that's the thing that's really lacking in Calgary right now. A stalwart defenseman that can play big minutes and clear the crease.
Says Scott Stevens is his favorite player, and there's certainly some similarities there. Other players he's often compared to, Barrett Jackman, Brian McCabe, guys who play an in-your-face physical style, and everybody remembers the big hit from the Prospects game when he knocked out Marc-Antoine Fourliette. That's led to a fight between Paul Bissonnette and Dion Phaneuf, and those guys were all teammates on the under-18 team, so they were really bringing it in that Prospects game. 6'2", a couple inches taller than Barrett Jackman, a little over 200 pounds, but plays that same tough, in-your-face style. And Daryl Sutter made no bones about it walking into the building today. He says, the Phaneufs there at 9, we're taking them. And that was as simple as that. But they really were worried that the three big defensemen, Suter, Coburn, and Phaneuf, would go 6, 7, and 8 to those three teams, and that they'd be left out of the defenseman sweepstakes.
You know, the other part about this is getting a player out of Red Deer. They're so well-schooled by Brent Sutter that guys that come out of there are really more mature.
Look at
that. He's all excited. How many times have you seen Daryl Sutter hug anybody? You know, holy man, that's unbelievable. That's great.
I don't think Daryl Sutter could be any happier than he is right at this moment.
This is a reflection on the Red Deer Rebels as well. They've done a great job creating and building players up within their organization. And Brent Sutter, the brother of Daryl, should be very proud of what they've accomplished up there in Red Deer.
Bob McKenzie, you had 9 players ranked from 1 to 9. They've all gone so far in this National Hockey League draft. And there's a look at the Calgary Flames first round history. It is not necessarily glittering. The Rico Fatta selection in 1998 did not go their way. But Brent Cron is an intriguing guy. He's had real knee problems as a goaltender. Chuck Kobosiew and Eric Nystrom, their last 2 first round picks before Dion Phaneuf.
Montreal Canadiens up next. Oh, here's Dave Strader. Sorry, guys.
All right, Daryl Sutter, the guys were just saying if there was ever a Sutter-type player, it's Dion Phaneuf. And I'm sure when San Jose selected Mikhailik, you knew you were going to be able to get one of the big three defensemen.
Well, obviously there were 3 kids that we loved dearly. We watched a lot of them, and it's interesting with Dion. I've seen that team play so much after going to Calgary with him being in Red Deer on brother Brent's team. So it's exciting for me because, you know, I know deep down he really wanted to come to Calgary too.
It's the most I've seen you smile in a long time. You've been a coach. How's the experience as a general manager?
I think it's been really good. I think we've been really busy, and you just kind of keep in perspective and work at it.
Well, congratulations on getting the guy you wanted.
Thanks, Dave.
All right, Gordon.
And tomorrow morning, he'll go back to work at 4:30 a.m. like he likes to do. Next up, the Montreal Canadiens, who have the number 10 pick in this draft. And the Canadiens, of course, that's Andre Savard, who is their outgoing general manager. Bob Gainey takes over as their new GM on July the 1st. And Andre Savard, you know, people have criticized the Canadiens, but the one thing Andre has done is he's really put some good prospects in the bank for Montreal.
They really want to get a forward here, and there are a lot of good ones on the board, a lot of guys with high skill. Guys like Dustin Brown from the Guelph Storm, Ryan Getzlaff from the Calgary Hitmen, Andre Kostitsyn, very controversial name that we'll talk a little bit as the day wears on. a Russian player who there's all sorts of talk about his medical conditions, but he's a high skill level guy. They'll be looking for a top end forward with this pick.
Well, Kostitsyn is a guy that's had three different physicals from people around the National Hockey League, and all his physicals have checked out. Trevor Timmons there with Andre Savard, Pierre Dorion coming up, Claude Julien, the coach, and there's Bob Gainey as well. A little bit of a surprise visitor, Bob Gainey up on the podium.
And here's Andre Savard, who remains with the Canadiens as Director of Player Personnel.
Bonjour, Nashville. We'd like to thank our old city, Nashville, for their kindness during the last few days. Congratulations to the New Jersey Devils for the Stanley Cup. With our 10th pick, le club de hockey, le Canadien, est heureux de sélectionner. The Montreal Canadiens are proud to select from CSKA Moscow, Andrei Kostitsyn.
Fascinating pick.
Really is. Absolute top-end offensive ability. Highly skilled, one of the most highly skilled players in the draft, but a lot of question marks. The Russian team was telling everybody that he has epilepsy. He certainly had some sort of seizure over the course of this season. But when he came to Toronto for the NHL Central Scouting Bureau testing, they went through a battery of medical tests, including one with doctors specializing in epilepsy, and he has been declared that he does not have epilepsy. They don't know what the cause of the seizure was, but whatever was bothering him, they believe it can be controlled with medication. There's talk that it might have been another disorder called cataplexy, which is not as serious as epilepsy. In any case, another factor that came into it, when he went to do the VO testing at the NHL Central Scouting Bureau physical combine, he really had a tough time with the apparatus and almost had a bit of an anxiety attack. And a lot of the European players are not familiar with that type of testing and aren't used to having all the gear put on them for such a difficult test on the bike. So lots of questions about his medical history, but this guy's an elite level prospect, and the Canadians are absolutely convinced that medical issues are not front and center.
And they shouldn't be, because independently he's been evaluated by three different doctors and they all said that he's fine. You know, the other thing is, I think we're now seeing the beginning of the Bob Gainey era. There were French-Canadian born players on the board that were really highly evaluated in terms of their ability to create offense, and the Canadians decided to go overseas rather than stay in the province of Quebec.
Well, if not for the medical problems, Bob, no question in your mind that Kostitsyn would have been maybe a top five pick.
Yeah, well, he's right where he belongs. He's a top 10 guy, right on the borderline of the top 10. And it was a medical condition that was scaring some people off that thought it might drop him down between 15 or 20 or even out of the top 20.
This breaks a mold for the Montreal Canadiens, who have been drafting U.S. college players most recently. When you look at Higgins, Komisarek, and Hainsey, Eric Chouinard has already been traded away by the Montreal Canadiens to the Philadelphia Flyers. Let's go to Dave Strader.
All right, Bob, with the selection of Andre with his medical condition, how much of a concern was that, and when were you sure that he was going to be the guy if he was available?
Well, he was on our list higher than 10th spot, and the way we've approached the draft was to take the player that was highest on our list. I think we're satisfied that any kinds of problems are either minor problems and things that will be resolved, or they've already been resolved, and I think we have a very talented young player to come into what will be a pool of young players in the Montreal organization.
Bob, you're new to the GM position, certainly not new to the Montreal Canadiens and their fans. Jose Theodore, unfortunately, has been in the news for some non-hockey things. Was that a distraction leading into this draft at all?
Not particularly. It was a story that I think was thrust upon him, and he's had to handle that, and we've had to respond to it, like you're asking me about it today. But this is really a day for these younger players, these new players, the future of the NHL, and keeping the focus there, I think they deserve it and we should do it.
All right, Bob, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Gordon?
Next up at the 2003 draft, Bob Clark and the Philadelphia Flyers. Our live coverage continues after this.
Going a full 12 rounds is all about stamina. That's why I like High Endurance from Old Spice. No deodorant protects better, and it lasts longer because it evaporates more slowly. Want proof? If you're not convinced, Old Spice will buy you a stick of your old stuff. Let me put it this way. High Endurance will last longer than I do, but I'm working on that.
And start your day with new body wash and body spray from Old Spice. Spice things up.
Mm-hmm. 8 out of 9 Toyota cars get over 30 miles per gallon. So what does that mean to you?
I'm going to Omaha.
A road trip to New Hampshire.
Los Angeles, Phoenix. San Diego, Phoenix.
I'm going to drive to Alvin's Ranch in Montana.
Cleveland.
With so many fuel-efficient cars, like the Prius Hybrid, you can drive anywhere in a Toyota. One more thought, don't forget the map.
No maps.
Value begins with Toyota quality.
The only love I have in my life.
Jay!
So don't tell me who to love. You have no idea how I feel. Excuse me. I was leaving.
Sensational play.
What?
They're down by 10 at the half. Now they come.
Excuse me.
Hey guys.
Hey, what's up, man?
Well,
what?
Forget it.
What's the matter?
I can't believe I changed my hair and you guys don't even notice.
You're not a woman. Why use a woman's gel? Try new Suave for Men. Holds as good as her brand for less.
Hey, I wasn't finished.
Wouldn't it be easier to just buy your own paper?
Easier? Yes. Cheaper? No. What?
For cheap and easy, dial 1010-220. No commitments, no monthly fees. Now that's easy.
Back here in Nashville, the 2003 Nashville Hockey League Entry Draft on TSN and ESPN2. The next pick, 11th overall, belongs to the Philadelphia Flyers. This might beg the question, how does a team with 107 points get the 11th pick in the draft? They got it from Phoenix last year when they moved Damon Lankow to the Coyotes. They got a second-round pick last year and the Coyotes' first pick this year. So Bobby Clark, Paul Holmgren have the 11th pick overall in the draft.
Philadelphia Flyers select from the Canadian Hockey League, Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds, Jeff Carter.
This one's got the fingerprints of Craig Hartsburg all over it. An assistant coach with the Philadelphia Flyers. He was the general manager and head coach of the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds a couple of seasons ago. A couple of seasons ago when Jeff Carter was the first round pick of the Greyhounds and was an effective player for the Greyhounds in his first year in that organization. This guy's a big, tall center and has good speed and a good goal scoring ability. And Craig Hartsburg would know firsthand that this, what they've seen so far in junior hockey from this guy, is just the tip of the iceberg. A London, Ontario native who played his minor hockey with the Elgin Middlesex Chiefs organization steps up. The Philadelphia Flyers have a big one. It was a choice between him or Marc-Antoine Pouliot, a player from the Quebec League, who also has some of the same characteristics as Carter.
Carter's a 6'3" guy, Pierre, so once again the Flyers stay true to form. In case the hockey thing doesn't work out, they can field a basketball team.
That's absolutely right, but what I like about him is the consistency he showed this year. It was a real tumultuous year in Sault Ste. Marie with John Van Biesbroek at the helm, and I thought this kid really handled himself well, to average over a point a game in the Ontario Hockey League, which isn't an easy thing to do, especially in such a tumultuous situation as he was in Sault Ste. Marie. So obviously he's got fine character and he's going to be a very good player for Philadelphia.
The Flyers, by the way, when you talk about teams that draft and develop well, are right up there with the best in the league in terms of New Jersey, Dallas, Detroit. Philadelphia has a ton of prospects coming. Don't forget, last year they made the trade with the Tampa Bay Lightning and got Yanni Pitkin and the big strapping defenseman who they may find in their lineup very soon.
Well, you have to credit guys like John Chapman and Dennis Patterson who have done such a good job, and they've been so loyal to Bob Clark for so long. They've got a scouting staff that's been really cemented for a long time in Philadelphia.
Worth noting about Jeff Carter, this year's first round pick, if you look at some of the history for the Philadelphia Flyers at the prospects game, he won the puck control and the fastest lap. So this guy can really move for a big man. And the Philadelphia Flyers love the speed element, especially that Simon Gagné gives them. Justin Williams is a great skater. And on the back end, Wojtkin, Pitkin, and two towers of powers back on the back end for Philly.
That's a great point by you, Bob. Wojtkin, Pitkin can really get after you. And that's something now you look at the strength of their team in Philadelphia. They got a ton of young guys coming for a long time.
107 points in the 11th overall pick of the draft. Doesn't get much better than that, Dave.
All right, Bob Clark, general manager. Jeff Carter, your selection, the guy you had targeted, the way things were unfolding?
Well, there was three centermen that we really liked, and he was the one that we liked the best. I don't think there was much to pick and choose between them, and for our organization, we thought he was the best.
The guys were speculating that Craig Hartsburg would have had a lot of say on this selection.
Well, Craig obviously knew him from the junior days, and he did have a strong say. He felt he was very competitive, and we know he's big and got lots of speed and lots of skills, so he fits into the style of player that we like.
All right, thanks very much, Bob. Gord?
There's Bob Clark, and the next pick belongs to the Flyers' arch rivals, the New York Rangers. Glenn Sather usually has a surprise or two up his sleeve.
Well, they're interested in a defenseman. The problem at this point is Glenn Sather gets up for a potential walk. is that the best defensemen have gone, the top three defensemen. Now, they could continue to pick a defenseman here, a guy like Mark Stewart or somebody like that. But there are also some big forwards out there, and there's been all sorts of talk as to whether they might trade this pick, and in fact, whether they might trade Jaromir Jagr, trade for Jaromir Jagr. But it looks like Sather's going to make the pick.
Sather makes his way by, and we will await the selection of the New York Rangers, who finished this year with 78 points, missed the playoffs for the sixth consecutive season. Boy, that's going to be tough for the Rangers when Philadelphia drafts ahead of you and they win the division.
Tom Rennie heading up to the podium with Glenn Sather. Tom Rennie's done such a good job. Don Maloney there as well.
The Flyers didn't win the division. They finished second in the division. Right. But nonetheless, we're well ahead of the New York Rangers. Here's Tom Rennie with the pick.
The New York Rangers would like to take this opportunity to thank the city of Nashville and what are obviously wonderful fans. We'd also like to take this opportunity to thank our fans back in Madison Square Gardens at our draft party and appreciate their loyal support. And at this time, we would like to announce our selection from Dartmouth College of the ECAC, Hugh Jessamine.
Here's a 6'5" guy, Bob, and Dartmouth. Not really on the track of most scouts and not on the beaten path here.
No, but I'll tell you one thing. Bob Gaudette's the coach there, and he's done a phenomenal job in helping really rebuild that franchise at Dartmouth University. The other thing about this kid, he comes from such a great athletic family. Both his parents were world-class rowers. He's a big body presence. He can lean on people. He scores magnificent goals. He lifts people out of the stands with his ability to beat people one-on-one. And for a big guy, that's not easy. A lot of his game is right there, as you see, hands in tight, and he can out-muscle people. That's one of the reasons that really endeared him, or one of the things that endeared him to the New York Rangers. And I just love the way he can bang. And New York has had so many soft players for so long. Now they can go out and get somebody that can really get after you. It's a great pick.
His nickname amongst the scouts is Huge Specimen. Because he's sick, as Gord pointed out, 6'4", 6'5", 200 pounds. Put up 23 goals as a freshman. Anytime anybody comes in to Division I college hockey, even if it's at a school like Dartmouth in the ECAC, and puts up 23 goals in his freshman season, you're going to get a lot of attention. And the scouts were flocking all year to see this guy who came so fast over the course of the season. His development day by day was accelerated. Going into this season, he was nowhere on the radar screen as a first-round pick in the National Hockey League. But when you're that big, you score that many goals, you're that mobile, you're going to attract a lot of attention.
You know, there have been other Ivy League players that have made a mark in the National Hockey League. Joe Nieuwendyk comes to mind from Cornell University. Ken Dryden from Cornell University. How about Kerry Wilson, who made an impact playing in the National Hockey League? He's now a doctor. Kerry Wilson went to Dartmouth University.
Guess what his favorite team is, guys? The New York Rangers. How often does that happen?
Well, he's a smart kid. He knows that there's more money to be had in New York than anywhere else. That's why he's a college kid.
Especially a Dartmouth college kid.
Exactly.
And he towers over the Ranger Brain Trust, and they couldn't be happier about that.
Man, especially when you can draft a player that can eat an apple off your head, you feel good about yourself as an organization. Look at Glenn Sather. He's just getting towered over by Jessamine. This is great for the Rangers. A lot of excitement for New York fans.
Interesting, some of the picks we've seen. Christensen went at 10 to the Montreal Canadiens, a guy that might have slipped because of worries about his medical condition. Jessamine was probably projected to go just a touch later than this, but not by much. But the fact that he went at this mark, number 12, for the New York Rangers, means other guys are getting pushed down. That means guys like Dustin Brown of the Guelph Storm haven't been taken yet. Marc-Antoine Pouliot of the Rimouski team has not been taken yet. So some real good forwards are starting to slide a little.
This has not been a Ranger strength over the years. The National Hockey League draft in recent years has been a real weak point for New York. They're hoping to turn that around with the selection of Hugh Jessamine. Here's Dave Strader.
All right, Glenn, the guys were just talking about your draft selection. Usually you have to wait for these young kids to grow into their body. It looks like this kid has already done that. Can he step right in?
Well, I'd like to be able to tell you that he can, but that's a tough mission for anyone. But he's a whale of a talent. We've done everything we can with him. We've watched him and studied him, and he looks like he's going to play. He's got a lot of ability.
Are you going to be the man behind the bench?
Well, that's a whole other question. We'll have to wait another day for that answer.
All right, Glenn, thanks very much.
Okay, thank you.
Gord?
Hugh Jessamine selected by the New York Rangers, and that takes us through the top dozen as the Flyers take Jeff Carter and the Rangers grab Jessamine. And our live coverage continues with Chicago and L.A. after this.
Can't step to Andre.
Priest home.
Shaq, Kobe.
He's my man.
You decide.
This year, your opinion counts. At the ESPYs, the greatest athletes in the world go head-to-head for the ultimate honor.
Now you can decide who's at the top of their game, but only if you vote.
How about Rich Gannon, Michael Vick,
KG,
T-Mac,
A-Rod?
So log on to ESPN.com, search ESPY, and cast your vote to see who will be crowned champion. The ESPY Awards, celebrating our love of sports, July 16th at 9 on ESPN.
You're looking at a remarkable gardening tool. It's the Mantis Tiller Cultivator. It weighs only 20 pounds, so you'll never have to battle big, bulky rototillers again. That's because the compact Mantis Tiller packs more power per pound than you might have thought possible. The patented Mantis tines dig in at 240 revolutions a minute, about twice as fast as those heavyweight machines. The Mantis Tiller is also perfect for work in tight areas, in vegetable gardens, in flower gardens, and around shrubs and bushes. The Mantis Tiller even has optional attachments to handle all kinds of gardening chores, from clipping hedges to trimming edges. This really is a remarkable machine. And here's a remarkable offer. Purchase a Mantis Tiller direct from the factory, use it for a year. If you don't absolutely love it, send it back and we'll refund your money. No ands, ifs, or buts. You won't find that kind of guarantee anywhere else.
For free information about the remarkable Mantis Tiller, call 1-800-888-4303.
ABC brings you exclusive coverage of the 2003 Buick Invitational today at 3 p.m. as Tiger Woods looks to win his 38th career PGA event against a star-studded field including Ernie Els and U.S. Open champ Jim Furyk. Despite his success, Tiger's never finished better than 16th at the Buick, and he comes into the third round at 6-under, 4 behind the leaders. It's round 3 of the Buick Open coming your way today on ABC Sports.
Welcome back to Nashville. This is a joyous day for the most part, but unfortunately there's some very sad news in the hockey world, and we'll go to Commissioner Gary Bettman for that.
Can I have your attention for a moment, please? I've just been advised of something that I need to pass on, particularly to the NHL family. Roger Nielsen, a great friend of the game, a great innovator, a great coach, and a great person, passed away this morning after a lengthy illness. And I'd like it if everybody would stand for a brief moment of silence. Roger, we'll all miss you. Thank you.
This is the news you dreaded. And we've been talking to the Ottawa people for the last couple of days about how Roger was doing, and this was a day, of course, that he loved. He knew most of the young players and knew all the coaches here from his camp, which was held last week in Windsor, Ontario.
I'm sure Roger would see something fitting about it actually being this day, if I may actually say that, because the entire National Hockey League family gathered, and nobody was a more treasured or valued member than that National Hockey League family than Roger Nielsen. Unbelievable grace, unbelievable dignity, under the most difficult circumstances a human being could possibly imagine. I don't know that you can say anything else more than that, Pierre.
Well, he's very committed to the game. He put his money where his mouth is. Not only did he sponsor clinics around the world, he was such a great friend of the sport. He owned his own junior team in Lindsay, Ontario. He did so much for young coaches, for young people, whether it be in North America or in Israel, where he was very fond of running youth hockey programs over there. He's a treasured friend of the hockey community. He did so much to help a lot of young coaches like myself when I was starting out. And it's a dark day for, you know, the National Hockey League. They're losing a great friend. But I think, Bob, you said it very well. And if Roger was going to pass away, this would have been an appropriate day for him to go, because he really cherished this day.
A day for hockey.
Yep.
The last pick in the draft was the New York Rangers. He coached them. And the next two are Los Angeles and Chicago. And guess what? He coached both of them as well. Here's Kings GM Dave Taylor.
The Los Angeles Kings would like to offer our condolences to Roger Nielsen's family. He spent some time in Los Angeles as our head coach, and I know he had a tremendous impact on the game of hockey and will be sorely missed. Los Angeles Kings would also like to thank the city of Nashville and the great fans of hockey here in Nashville for your warm reception today. We'd also like to offer a special hello to our season seat holders at a draft party back at Hollywood and Highland in Los Angeles, and our friends in Manchester, New Hampshire. At this time, Al Murray would like to make our selection.
I'd
Los Angeles Kings are pleased to select from Guelph of the Canadian Hockey League, Dustin Brown.
Dustin Brown was the second rated skater by NHL Central Scouting among North Americans, the Canadian Hockey League Scholastic Player of the Year twice. A real character guy, Bob.
Absolutely, and a great goal scorer, a prototypical pro winger, little over 6 feet, little over 200 pounds, a terrific goal scorer when he gets in tight, can play the power game, can play the physical game. Didn't play particularly well at the World Junior Championship, and while he was the number two rated skater by NHL Central Scouting in North America, I don't think he did anything over the course of this year to see his stock fall on draft day. People thought he might have been a top five pick at some point, other than teams like somebody else better. And certainly there was a case of this year with the draft being the way it is. There was a lot of individual team preferences in terms of the defenseman that pushed a guy like Dustin Brown a little lower than people thought he would go.
He's another one of these players that's creating a new trend. He's an American-born player that's come to Canada and played major junior hockey, and he did very well in that situation. Not an easy thing for an American kid to do. Anytime you can get 34 goals in 58 games in major junior, Bob, that's a heck of an accomplishment.
And he's played back-to-back years in the World Junior Championship. This guy's a real thoroughbred and will play in the National Hockey League and will score a lot of goals for the Los Angeles Kings given time.
A native of Ithaca, New York. How did Cornell University not get him? But fascinating, too, that he's a guy that a lot of scouts talk about as potentially being a captain of a team at some point. So you get the goal scoring, you get the skating, but you also get the characters of the Los Angeles Kings, who are picking 13th. Pretty happy with the selection of Dustin Brown.
They're starting to add some nice little offensive pieces to the puzzle. They reacquired Joseph Stumpel yesterday from the Boston Bruins to play along with Ziggy Palfy. They all remember Ziggy Palfy, such a great goal scorer. They have Jason Allison already in place. Adam Denmark should be back. The Los Angeles Kings are starting to put together a high-powered attack-oriented team, which is good for them.
Well, they're drafting 13th overall basically because they were racked by injuries last year. So here's a look at their first-round history. Dennis Grebushkov here is a player you love.
Oh, my goodness. I just can't believe Dennis Grebushkov was still available when the LA Kings picked last year. He will be an impact defenseman in the National Hockey League. And Alexander Frolov's already proven that he can play in the league. So the Los Angeles Kings, again, are going in the right direction.
All right, the next pick in this draft belongs to the Chicago Blackhawks. And some of their fans are here heckling the Hawks' brain trust as they'll make their way forward. Mike Smith, the GM of Chicago, is a hands-on guy who tends to like to make decisions for his scouts, and he is now on the telephone. So we may have a swap here.
Well, what's happening here is that Mike Smith would like a defenseman. At this point, though, there are a lot better forwards on the board than there are defensemen. So it behooves Mike Smith to find out if there's a team out there that's more interested in getting one of those high-profile forwards. A guy like Ryan Getzlaff, a guy like Zach Parise, a guy like Marc-Antoine Pouliot. People like that are available now. Other teams are interested, and it would almost be foolish for the Chicago Blackhawks to jump in and immediately take a defenseman at this point who could be had a little later in the draft, because the defensemen that are out there, guys like Mark Stewart, Brent Seabrook, are all guys that could be had later.
Chicago's had a history of taking guys from the University of North Dakota as well. If you think about Eddie Belfour, who came over there, and years back, many more players from the University of North Dakota. So it wouldn't surprise me if they went to the forward position, if maybe they went for Zach Parise, Bob.
They're interested in a defenseman. The two defensemen on the board, Mark Stewart from Colorado College and Brent Seabrook, who plays in the Western Hockey League, the captain of the Lethbridge Hurricanes, and a guy who's played both under 18 and under 17 hockey for Canada. Going into this draft, I know that Mike Smith said he really liked the leadership capabilities of a guy like Seabrook. So if there's no trade to be made and they want a defenseman, Seabrook or Stewart would be their man.
Bill Azuk is their director of amateur scouting. He's the lead man there with a sweater in his hand. The Chicago Blackhawks have only selected two defensemen in their last 13 first-round picks. And we're going to look at who the Blackhawks decide upon.
I'll tell you right now, they're not going the European route. They're going to take a North American player.
Mike Smith knows Europeans, and Mike Smith, like everybody else, says this is a very poor year for the European crop of talent. Nick Beverly with the announcement.
Chicago Blackhawks are very pleased to make our first round selection from Lethbridge, WHL, Brent Seabrook.
Brett Seabrook, as Bob McKenzie mentioned, from the Lethbridge Hurricanes of the Western Hockey League, a diamond in the rough, would you say?
Well, absolutely. Brent Seabrook probably didn't have as good a season as some of the scouts thought he was going to have. He was considered something of a disappointment going into the season. A lot of people believed he could be a top 10, top 12 pick in this year's National Hockey League entry draft. Most of the scouting services had him rated somewhere between the 20 and 30 mark. But I'll tell you this about Brent Seabrook, and every scout will tell you this as well. One of the big factors in his development is that he's a great leader. The captain of the Lethbridge Hurricanes, a young captain of the Lethbridge Hurricanes. He also captained Canada's under-18 team and played extremely well in international competition for the Canadian Hockey Association, whatever he was called. So this guy is a big-time leader in a lot of ways. And step up, he can play that all-around game, but he can also play physically. He's got to get himself in a little better shape, and that seemed to be one of the knocks on him this year, that he had to battle injuries, and that maybe his conditioning wasn't as good as some people would have liked to have seen it.
For a bigger man who's a mature player, one of his real strengths, too, is his stick. He's got a great stick. He makes great first pass, a very good stick handler. He can shoot the puck through a wall, so that's something that's going to endear him to the Chicago Blackhawks. But Bob talked about the conditioning level. There are a lot of young players that still have to do their chores when it comes to understanding conditioning, and he's no different player from anybody else. As a young man, he's still going to have to learn a lot about taking care of his body.
Well, the Blackhawks need help on the blue line, and they will no doubt be glad to get it. Bobby, you had him ranked as the 27th player on the TSN list.
That's right. A lot of people thought he would go between 20 and 30, but the Blackhawks, drafting by position, wanting a defenseman more than wanting a forward, decided they liked him. If you like somebody, you jump in on him. And that's true of this draft. There are a lot of people in this draft where teams are going to be jumping up and taking somebody who might not be the consensus pick at that point because they like him.
Well, the Blackhawks, when Mike Smith took over, began dipping into the pool of Europeans. You see Yakubov, Ruutu, and Babchuk. By the way, Tuomo Ruutu still not signed by the Blackhawks, and that's turned into a real contentious issue for the Hawks, who would desperately like to get him over to North America. The next picks belong to the Islanders and the Bruins. We'll have them for you when we come back to Nashville after this.
Wendy's hometown of Dublin, Ohio may be in the Midwest, but these days it feels like the Southwest. All thanks to our new Southwest Chicken Caesar Salad. Spicy pieces of seasoned chicken filet, seasoned corn and black beans, romaine and Southwest Caesar dressing that gives it a taste as big as all get out.
Yahoo! Sorry.
The new Southwest Chicken Caesar Salad at Wendy's. It's better here. And our pickup window is open till midnight or later, so eat great even late.
Drinks before lunch?
Water's fine for me.
Water for me too, but with lemon, please.
I'll have a Sam Adams, please.
Make that two Sam Adams.
Oh, I'll have a Sam also. Me four.
Nice. Never miss an opportunity to enjoy a tasty Samuel Adams lager, especially when it's on someone else's tab. Samuel Adams, always a good decision.
Now playing.
Welcome back to Nashville in the 2003 National Hockey League Entry Draft here on TSN and ESPN2. The first 14 picks of the draft have been made. Anthony Stewart, who we showed you earlier, sits there with his dad Norman and awaiting his selection. TSN's Bob McKenzie has him ranked as the 21st ranked player for this draft, so that would make him wait five or six more picks.
Norman, by the way, is an absolute Montreal Canadian fanatic. He loves the Montreal Canadiens more than anything else in the world. And Anthony, of course, played for the North York Canadiens, wore the Canadiens colors all the way up in the GTHL and the Toronto Hockey League.
All right, so now we get into an interesting situation here with the draft. You got a guy like Zach Parise. We saw him at the World Junior Hockey Championship, the son of J.P. Parise, who had a great National Hockey League career. If he's over 6 feet tall, he's gone by now. Pierre, you want someone to go out there and take a chance at this guy.
Absolutely. This has become nonsensical, this knock on small players. This is a guy with so much upside offensively. Size isn't going to be a factor. He's the hardest worker on his team at the University of North Dakota. He's been well-trained. Andy Murray was his coach at Shattuck St. Mary's.
Berries in Minnesota before he went to the University of North Dakota. He is a pure winner. It would behoove any team that wants offense, character, and skill to take Zach Parise right now.
Hey, there's lots of good forwards available. This is a deep draft. There are an awful lot of good players. Marc-Antoine Fouliot hasn't gone yet. Ryan Getzlaf hasn't gone yet. Lots of good forwards. Wouldn't be surprised if the Islanders take one here. Tony Feltrin.
Organization. I'd like to say a special hello to our terrific fans at Jillian's at our draft party, and I think it only appropriate that on this day the former player of Rogers makes our announcement. Doug Gibson.
Tony Feltro speaking there for the Islanders, and now the pick.
New York Islanders are pleased to select from Leksand, Sweden, Robert Nielsen.
Oh. Well, you're talking about bloodlines. Yeah. There is the son of the Magic Man. Kent Nielsen's son, and Robert Nielsen has now been selected by the New York Islanders.
I don't like this pick. I don't like it at all. I can't believe the New York Islanders would go over to Europe and take a player who's got fine skill and he's a good player, and we saw him at the World Junior and he's got tremendous upside. But the fact that Zach Parise is still out there is unbelievable and almost unconscionable that they wouldn't take him.
I love it. Pierre's all wound up at the NHL entry draft. Robert Nielsen, you mentioned it, Gord, the son of the Magic Man, Kent Nielsen. 5'11", some people wonder if he's actually that big. The knock is that he's not a real big player, so he gets a little congratulations from agent John Baisley. But Robert Nielsen played well for Sweden at the World Junior Hockey Championship. A guy who's got some great offensive ability, some great skill, but a great inconsistency to his game. And there were an awful lot of, this is for the New York Islanders going off the board a little bit. Again, this is a player that a lot of people thought will go between 20 to 30, but a little concerned about his size, a little concerned about his skating sometimes, and those factors thought might push him down a little bit further. And it is a bit of a surprise pick, and Pierre doesn't like it. He's all wound up.
And that's what drives me nuts. Everybody's putting the knock on Parise, saying he's too short. I bet you Parise's as tall as Robert Nielsen. And I'll tell you what, he's playing against men. This guy's still playing against boys, and let's be honest, the Swedish Elite League is not developing players the way it once did. There's been a little bit of a dark hole there the last 7 to 10 years. I like the player. I think he's got talent, but the New York got Anders Kahler right there, their Swedish scout, is along with the player. There's Mike Milbury talking to Daryl Sutter. But Gord, I have to tell you, the fact that Parise's out there and they didn't take him is a little bit troublesome.
They may have to answer that question because, of course, Parise played for the Islanders too.
It's also worth noting, though, Robert Nielsen scored 21 points in the Swedish Elite League with Leksand this year. That broke a Swedish Elite League record for a rookie, Marcus Naslund's record. So Nielsen can put points on the board. He's creative, he's smart, often compared to Michael Nylander, a player that you once coached here.
And you see Anders Kahler there, just trailing their European scout. And of course, technically, Nielsen is a North American. He was born in Calgary when his dad played there. I think we have to put him down as a European. Mike Rupp, of course, was not signed by the Islanders. He went back into the draft and was taken by the Devils. Connolly, DiPietro, Stillman, and Sean Bergenheim. So back-to-back picks in the first round from Sweden for the New York Islanders. The next pick belongs to the Boston Bruins. They have dealt the pick. Here is Gary Bettman.
I have a trade to announce involving the next pick. Boston trades its first round pick in this year's draft, number 16 overall, to the San Jose Sharks in exchange for San Jose's picks number 21, 66, and 107, all in this year's draft. The next pick in this draft, the 16th, belongs to the San Jose Sharks.
So that's a fourth round pick, a second round pick. This, by the way, the Sharks dealt the first round pick that they got from Toronto for Owen Nolan. So that now belongs to the Boston Bruins at 21. San Jose now, which has already made a pick, selecting Michael Mihalak from the Czech Republic, will now pick 16th overall as Doug Wilson gets set to go back up.
I can only hope they're going to take Zach Parise with the pick up here going down the floor.
I just think you've got to salute guys that have great creativity and courage and leadership, and that's the thing Zach Parise has.
I'll tell you this. There was a terrific undrafted free agent at Colorado College this year that a lot of colleges, a lot of NHL scouts went to see, but that allowed Mark Stewart, who's a pretty good defenseman, to get a lot of time from NHL scouts. So I wonder if it's Mark Stewart from Colorado College. And Mr. Wilson with his coach, Ron Wilson, no relation. We'll pick for the second time. By the way, San Jose has six picks in the top 100 in this year's draft.
And credit former general manager Dean Lombardi for acquiring a lot of those picks.
And here comes Doug Wilson.
Thank you, Nashville, for the hospitality that we've had this week. But I also want to pass on to Roger Nielsen's family. I had the privilege of not only playing for him, but having him impact my life. So my thoughts and prayers go to Nielsen family.
San Jose selects from the Moncton Wildcats, Steve Bernier.
Steve Bernier, 49 goal scorer in the Quebec Major Junior League. He's got size. He's about 6'3". He weighs, they say, about 233 pounds.
Well, it's interesting the weight. Steve Bernier at the National Hockey League Central Scouting Combine in Toronto in the physical testing probably tested as poorly as any potential first-round pick in recent memory. There wasn't a scout that came away from that exercise that didn't say they were absolutely shocked and appalled with the poor level of conditioning of Steve Bernier. So why does he get drafted 16th overall by the San Jose Sharks? A couple of things. Number one, he's got great hands. 49 goals, 101 points. He's got huge size. He's a good skater, although he's got to work on his first step. But also, one of the big factors, from the time of the NHL Central Scouting Combine in early June to now, he's lost more than 10 to 15 pounds. He's been committed over the last few weeks to get himself into some sort of playing shape, and that was recognized. That a guy can score 49 goals and 101 points and be out of shape and not be physically fit, Pierre, what could he do if he gets himself in shape? So that's the upside.
That certainly is the upside, Bob, and I'm sure that's what Doug Wilson and Tim Burke were thinking about when they chose Steve Bernier. I had a chance to watch him play in the Air Canada Cup final a couple of seasons ago in Prince George, British Columbia, where he played for St. Foy before he was a first player pick in the Quebec Major Junior League draft. He had tremendous hand skill and finishing ability back then, and I'm sure he'll carry that forward, but conditioning is the question, and he'll have to become very regimented and really personally disciplined if he's going to make it to the next step.
Well, the Sharks might be confident, though. Remember Jonathan Chichu, that was a knock on him cutting out of junior hockey, that he wasn't in great shape, but Jonathan Chichu was a pretty nice contributor in limited action this year for the Sharks.
And this kid really dominated at the under 18 tournament. He's played against some of the best players in the world for his age and excelled offensively. The only real knock coming into this draft was the lack of conditioning and maybe a little concern that when he gets to the pro game, he has to work on that first step. He's pretty mobile for a big man, just needs to improve his quickness, and that'll come with the conditioning.
Next up, the Edmonton Oilers. General manager Kevin Lowe was their first ever first round pick. He's going to make a selection in 2003 next.
We couldn't help but wonder, was there something in their character, some unique genetic code that allowed them to tap into unseen forces? Or had their motherboard simply shorted out? Then we realized Dell designers find inspiration in all sorts of places. They're constantly looking for ways to make Dell products better both inside and out, like the Inspiron notebooks. That's just what they do. Turns out their motherboards were just fine.
Get all these great products today, like this Dimension desktop with a 17-inch monitor and an Intel Pentium 4 processor for just $4.99 after mail-in rebate. Call or go online now and get a free CD burner. And check out our new notebooks. You're not just getting quality, you're getting a Dell.
It's beautiful.
Awesome technology as easy as Dell. Dell PCs use Intel Pentium 4 processors.
In the middle of your screen is Zach Parise, sitting next to his dad, JP. He's waiting to be picked. This is the tough time for guys who are rated in the first round of the NHL draft. Parise waits, so too does Anthony Stewart, who we have rated as the 21st ranked prospect for this 2003 National Hockey League draft. The next pick belongs to the Edmonton Oilers, and the Oilers have done an excellent job in recent years of selecting in the first round. Yeah. But I said we have a trade to announce, and here's Gary Bettman.
Go ahead.
I have three trades to announce, one involving the next pick.
Yes.
Edmonton trades number 17 overall in this year's draft to New Jersey in exchange for New Jersey's picks number 22 and 68 in this year's draft. So the next selection in this draft goes to the Stanley Cup champion New Jersey Devils. And while we're waiting for them to do that, Boston trades Joseph Stumpel and their own seventh round pick in 2003. That's the 213th pick overall to Los Angeles in exchange
for Detroit's second-round pick in 2004, previously acquired by the Kings, and Philadelphia's fourth-round pick in this year's draft, number 129 overall, again previously acquired by Los Angeles. And the third trade, Phoenix trades Danny Markoff and a conditional pick in either the 2004 or 2005 NHL entry drafts to Carolina in exchange for David Tanabe and Igor Niyazev. New Jersey's up next.
Here's a fascinating story about this New Jersey draft pick. The reason the Stanley Cup champions were able to pick 22nd in the draft was that the St. Louis Blues were found to have tampered with Scott Stevens in the early 1990s. It didn't come to light until the ownership changed in St. Louis. And so the Devils had the right to get a first round pick from St. Louis, which they did 2 years ago, and then the right to switch picks with St. Louis, which they're doing this year. And so the Devils, who draft better than anyone, are now moving up, and they're in the number 17 spot.
This is going to be humorous, because if they take Zach Parise, who plays with David Hale, who was a first-round pick of the Devils, who plays at University of North Dakota, it goes to show you the brilliance of their scouting department and some of the other people around this league that don't pay attention to trends. These guys draft better than anybody else. And if Zach Parise goes here, shame on some of the other people. And this guy's the best at it.
David Conte is a guy revered in hockey circles as perhaps the best draft day guy in the league.
There's a reason why the Devils are champions year after year after year. They draft character, they draft skill, they draft intelligence, they draft heart, and they draft leaders. And I'm telling you, if it's Parise, shame on some people.
All right, David Conte with Lou Lamoriello.
On behalf of the New Jersey Devils, we'd like to thank Craig Leopold, Jack Diller, and David Poile, and the entire Nashville organization and all its fans for its fine hospitality. And also, we'd like to thank our fans back home watching this draft. And for our selection, I'm going to ask David Conte to make it.
New Jersey Devils are proud to select from the University of North Dakota, Zach Parise.
Well, there it is.
Pierre's happy now, and so are the New Jersey Devils, because they got a heck of a prospect. When we saw this guy play at the World Junior Hockey Championship, you can tell that he's got potential written all over him. This is a very smart hockey player, a creative hockey player. He sees the ice as well as just about anybody in this draft, and he's a class act all the way. He's got great bloodlines. Father J.P. Parise, terrific guy out of Shattuck St. Mary's, who went to the University of North Dakota and was an impact freshman with that team.
Okay, let's just go over it. Brian Gionta, championship guy, Stanley Cup winner. Marty Brodeur, championship guy, Stanley Cup winner. You go down the line. All the New Jersey Devils do is draft talent, heart, skill, and professionalism. And this guy has it all. He will be an impact player for the New Jersey Devils for a long period of time. The other part of it, think about it. David Hale was a signed player by the New Jersey Devils this year. Just finished his third season at the University of North Dakota. So they had a chance to see Zach Parise play a ton, because Lou Lamoriello never signs anybody until the scouts give the forward to go ahead. And so they watched Zach Parise play as much as anybody else in the National Hockey League.
Well, there's J.P. Parise, who, as we mentioned, had a terrific career in the National Hockey League. And Zach Parise had that uncomfortable weight the prospects go through. But when you get picked by the defending Stanley Cup champions, who traded up just to get you, that's a pretty big honor.
And now you guys understand my sense of frustration. Don't knock this guy because he's not tall. I mean, Lou Lamoriello is about 5'8". You know, Zach Parise is about 2 inches tall, so he's at least 5'11". And I'm telling you right now, size is not a factor with this player. Brian Gionta is a heck of a player for the Devils, and Brian Gionta doesn't have the offensive skills that this guy has.
I'll tell you what, the Canadian coaching staff talked about him at the World Junior Championship, that every time he was on the ice, the United States had a scoring chance. Really was something.
Look at the Cheshire grins on those guys. They're laughing. They can't believe this player was still available. It's humorous.
And when you talk about elite teams of the draft, the conversation starts with New Jersey. The Devils are not only competitive every year, but they draft very, very well. Mike Van Ryn in 98 has moved on in a trade. Ariel Honen is a goaltender who played this year for their minor league team in Albany, Hale, Foster, and Kanikin. Here's Dave Strader.
All right, with Zach Parise. And Zach, I just got a call from Darren Pang, who's with his son at a camp up at Shattuck St. Mary's. They're all at the rink where you played before you went to college, and they said be sure to send along their best when you got selected, and it's got to be a pleasure to be with the defending Stanley Cup champions.
Yeah, it is. It's quite the honor to be, you know, like you said, with the defending Stanley Cup champions. This is awesome. And to Panger back at Shattuck, say hey to him and all those guys working the camp back home.
Not only with the defending champions, but the guys upstairs were making the point that they traded up to get you. They probably couldn't believe you were still available, so that shows that they really want you.
I sure hope so, and you know, hopefully things will work out, and this is just a great day, great feeling right now.
Congratulations, Zach.
Thank you very much.
Gord?
Zach Parise was ranked 12th by Bob McKenzie in our TSN ranking. Ryan Getzlaff is the top-rated player you have available from the Calgary Hitmen, and the next pick belongs to the Washington Capitals. But prior to that, here again is Dave Strader.
Hi, Lou Lamoriello. Congratulations on the cup. You win a cup, you move up to number 16 overall, and you get a guy that the guys upstairs were saying shouldn't have been here.
Well, that's the way we felt. We didn't know we'd even have a chance at him. In fact, ironically, we didn't even have a name tag for him because we didn't think he'd be there. So we're delighted.
How, as you watched it unfold, when did you realize you were going to be able to jump in there and maybe make this deal to move up and get him?
Not until just prior to the pick. We called Edmonton just now and just made the transaction.
Pierre was saying upstairs that, you know, there's a knock on his size, perhaps. But when you look at Breland, Madden, Gianta, and the guys that just won a championship, I can't believe anybody would doubt that that the size would be an issue if the kid can play.
No, not with the size of his heart. That's what we measure in this young man.
All right. Congratulations again on the cup.
Thank you.
Gord?
There's the Devils GM, and here's the GM of the Washington Capitals, George McPhee. His chief scout is Ross Mahoney. The Westling scout is Dale Durkach, a smaller guy himself who had not a bad career in hockey.
It'd be interesting to see Ross Mahoney scouts all over, but based in the Western Hockey League, Ryan Getzlaff still available. Would they be interested at this point? We'll find out in a moment.
They have a history, the Capitals do, of taking players from the Western Hockey League, Boyd Gordon. They also drafted Chris Beach out of the Western League. He was traded to Pittsburgh for Jaromir Jagr. A lot of suggestions of the Caps maybe trying to move Jaromir Jagr this summer, one of many big-name, big-money players who could be moved.
Personally, I think you're going to see Jaromir Jagr traded this summer and probably to the New York Rangers.
I would agree with that.
Here's George McPhee.
Washington Capitals are pleased to select from the Brandon Wheat Kings, Eric Fair.
Eric Fair, the native of Winkler, Manitoba, a Brandon Wheat King right winger.
Well, they went to the Western Hockey League, Gord. They just didn't take Ryan Getzlaff from the Calgary Hitmen. Eric Fair, a big raw bone kid from the Brandon Wheat Kings, has the ability to score some goals. Guy who really is a project. He's still got to fill out, obviously, 6 foot, 387 pounds, but that's pretty much true of all of these guys. But everybody likes the way this guy plays the physical game. He goes to the net hard, and he's able to score goals. He scored 26 goals in his second season with Brandon in the Western Hockey League, up from 11 the year before. And what you like to see from junior hockey prospects, the good ones anyway, they need to at least more than double their production from first year to second year. 11 goals first year, 26 goals second year. 27 points his first year, 55 points his second year. It's the right pattern. He's a good skater. He's mobile. Some people have compared him to a young Dave Andrechuk.
Well, Dave Andrechuk was known for having a terrific shot and a goal scorer shot, and that's exactly what Eric Fair has. He's got a tremendous shot for a young player. His release is excellent. When you talk to scouts around the Western Hockey League, the one thing that continually comes up is his ability to score, so that's a positive for the Washington Capitals, who don't score very easily, Gordon.
Yeah, and the Capitals, we mentioned, have a history of going to the West, so Ross Mahoney and company have struck again, and the Washington Capitals now have picked Eric Fair. We mentioned, you know, you talk about labor unrest coming in the NHL. These first-round picks might not get signed until whatever comes after September 15th, 2004. So you have to suggest that, at the very least, Fair is going to go back to the Brandon Wheat Kings for at least one more year. You see Beach from the Western Hockey League, Sutherby from the Western League, Nathan Page from the Western Hockey League as well, going back into the draft, actually, and Steve Eminger from the Ontario League's Kitchener Ranger. The next pick belongs to the Cinderella of this past spring. What do the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim have in store? We'll find out when we come back to Nashville right after this.
There's one tournament where the competition isn't among men and women, but rather gentlemen and ladies. And the tradition of 125 years makes this slam the grandest of them all. Wimbledon 2003 begins Monday on ESPN2.
Thank you.
Welcome back. It's me, James Carville, again, and I was just about to call in phone and have them make a dinner reservation for me and a few senators. Let me show you how it's done. You call 888-411-1111.
Hello, this is InPhone.
Hello, InPhone.
Hello, Mr. Carville.
I'd love to get a table for four at a restaurant called Junior's. Can you help me with that?
Absolutely, Mr. Carville.
You see, you just call InPhone and you tell them where you want to eat, and they'll go ahead and make the reservation. They'll do just about everything but chew the food for you. And can you try to get me an out-of-the-way table?
Going a full 12 rounds is all about stamina. That's why I like High Endurance from Old Spice. No deodorant protects better. And it lasts longer because it evaporates more slowly. Want proof? If you're not convinced, Old Spice will buy you a stick of your old stuff. Let me put it this way. High Endurance will last longer than I do. But I'm working on that.
And start your day with new body wash and body spray from Old Spice. Spice things up.
How do you keep a car from ending up like this? Try Armor. Armor All Protectant. It does more than clean and shine. It protects.
The Mighty Ducks of Anaheim are up next at the 2003 National Hockey League Entry Draft here in Music City, Nashville, Tennessee.
Thank all our great fans back in Anaheim at our watch party watching the draft today. Anaheim selects from Calgary, Ryan Getzlaff.
That's Tim Murray, Director of Player Personnel for the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. And the pick is the top player that you had remaining available, Bob, Ryan Getzlaff of the Calgary Hitmen of the Western Hockey League.
Here's a guy who's a real raw talent. 29 goals, 68 points in 70 games with the Calgary Hitmen. But when you look at the physical package, 6'2", 195 pounds, he's a skilled player, goes to the net hard, can score some goals, but he also knows how to play the two-way game. He's pretty good off the puck as well. He understands the defensive responsibility, even though that he's a young player. Doesn't do either one of the two things extremely well. That is, he's not a premier offensive player, he's not a premier defensive player, so he's a little bit of a tweener, which might be one of the reasons why he jumped from 11 on our list down to 18 where the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim took him. But this guy's got all sorts of potential to be a strong two-way forward, if not a number two center in the National Hockey League, certainly a number three that can put some points on the board.
And it's an intangible. The Mighty Ducks of Anaheim desperately need some size and some oomph going up and down the walls, and that's one thing that Ryan Getzlaff can bring to them. You know, when they were playing as the Stanley Cup playoffs went along, Gordon, I think you and I both know, they started to wear out as a team, and Mike Babcock, their coach, said, we need to get some bigger people, and this is one of the examples of the big people they got to add to their roster.
Native of Regina, Saskatchewan, and the Ducks have vowed they'll be bigger. By the way, that's probably the last time you'll see that uniform. The Ducks are changing their uniform this summer to a much more traditional, you want to say conservative look for next season. And Alan Shaney, the man on the right, is an original Duck, their chief scout, and he's been with that franchise since day one. The Mighty Ducks were stuck on smaller guys and Europeans for a while. Alexei Smirnov is taller, Chistov smaller, and then they got Joffrey Lupo last year, another breakout year this year in the Western Hockey League. Let's go down to Dave Strader.
All right, Brian Murray, general manager, congratulations on the great playoff run. You were telling me earlier this morning you really liked the forwards in your organization. You thought you might get a defenseman, but this kid was too good to pass up at number 18.
Well, we had another defenseman in order, but you know, one of the guys we thought might have been there earlier, he was gone, obviously, and Ryan was one of the guys we had rated pretty high, and a big strong kid, 6'3", so it's pretty tough to not to take a player of that nature.
Recent years we've seen some Stanley Cup finalists that have lost fall off the following year. Why won't that happen with the Mighty Ducks?
Well, I think we've got a lot of character. We've got great goaltending, a good defensive core, and we've got enough forwards right now that play at a high level that allow us to compete every night and challenge our players at the same time to be good coming into camp.
All right, Brian, congratulations.
Thanks, Dave.
Gord?
All right, thanks very much. Bob McKenzie, what do you got for us?
Well, the Minnesota Wild are up with the next pick, and all I'm going to say is expect them to go off the board here and make what would be considered a significant surprise pick in the first round.
There's Doug Risebrow, the general manager. Now, interesting here, we talked about Mark Stewart earlier from Colorado College. He's a native of Rochester, Minnesota. Now, you know that in Minnesota, they love the homegrowns, but do they go right off the board?
Well, they go off the board, and I can tell you they're looking to Brampton, Ontario, I would think, for a bit of a surprise pick. A guy that was rated as a consensus second rounder with a chance to sneak into the first rounder. A guy who used to play defense, now plays forward. I think this is going to be Brent Burns of the Brampton Battalion.
And if it is, he fits right into their game plan, and that is a guy that's got tremendous defensive savvy and awareness, and Jacques Lemaire loves players like that because he thinks he can teach them the other parts of the game.
And of course, when you're a recent expansion team that goes to the Stanley Cup semifinal, you're doing something right. Here's Tommy Thompson, their chief scout.
Thank you, Nashville and the Predators, for a job well done. And thanks to all the Minnesota Wild supporters throughout the hockey world, with special thanks to the dedicated people that followed us to Denver and Vancouver and Anaheim. You truly made it a season worth remembering. And congratulations to the New Jersey Devils, who continue to be a role model of how to build and develop a championship team. For our first claim in the 2003 entry draft, the Minnesota Wild are proud to select from the Brampton Battalion of the Ontario Hockey League, right winger Brent Burns.
Fascinating that he's ranked 39th among North American skaters. So when you factor in Europeans and goaltenders, he projects out to a middle to late second round pick.
I'm going
to
tell you something else. In the midseason rankings in NHL Central Scouting Bureau, he was ranked 101st. Frank Pinello of NHL Central Scouting said no player that he's ever been aware of has jumped as high from 101 to 39 from the midterm rankings to the final rankings. Here's what the Minnesota Wild like. Here's a guy who a year and a half ago was 5'9". He's now 6'3". He's now well over 200 pounds. From January 1st to the end of the OHL regular season, the guy averaged a point per game. And in the playoffs for the Brampton Battalion, he was their leading scorer. He's only playing forward for the first time in his career. Stan Butler and the Brampton Battalion drafted him as a defenseman, decided that he would be better as a forward, and he's really showing unbelievable improvement. The Minnesota Wild would have liked to wait to the second round to get this guy, but they liked him so much, they decided that he wasn't going to be there when they were picking in the second round, so they decided to jump in, follow up the courage of their convictions, and Tom Thompson decided that's the guy we wanted, and we didn't want to miss out on him. We had to take him at 20, even though it's probably higher than anybody else would have taken him.
Bob and Gord, this is a monster compliment to Stan Butler, the general manager and coach of the Brampton Battalion. It goes to show the respect level that NHL teams have for this gentleman and the way he develops players. You had Jay McClement last year, just signed with St. Louis. Now you've got Brent Burns. I mean, Stan Butler's done a phenomenal job as an organizer for the Brampton Battalion, helping his players go to the next level.
Well, he will go to a hockey-mad area, and he will go to a team very much on the upswing. Excellent coaches and an outstanding core of young players that you see Guy Lapointe on the left.
I do have to ask, though. Now, Pierre got mad at the Islanders for passing on Parise and taking Nilsson. Are you mad at all at the Minnesota Wild that they didn't take another player, or is this okay?
Well, this is okay because it fits into their schematic, and this is exactly what we're talking about. They drafted with a purpose, and their purpose is they wanted to add players with a huge upside, and this guy has that upside.
All right. The Minnesota Wild have made their pick. A look at their brief first-round history. Pretty darn good when you consider Marian Gabrick's already a star on the NHL, Mikko Koivu on the way, and Pierre-Marc Bouchard was in their lineup last season. Marc-Andre Fleury, the number one pick overall in this year's draft by the Pittsburgh Penguins, followed by Eric Staal, who went to the Carolina Hurricanes. Our coverage continues from Nashville with Boston after this.
I need to go to the men's room. You want to come with me?
Sure.
Your hair looks great to me.
Thanks, just got it done.
You're not a woman. Why use a woman's shampoo? Try new Suave for Men. Cleans just as good as her brand for less.
The Pizzone is back at Pizza Hut.
What's a Pizzone?
It's just $2.99 when you get any large pizza at regular price. A big taste and a big folded pizza crust filled with cheese and luscious toppings. No one makes the whole family happy like Pizza Hut.
So this is a Pizzone.
If the last thing you want to do is get married.
Welcome to the family. You can call me Pussy now.
Pussy?
You know, like a cat.
Then bring home Just Married on DVD for your girlfriend.
I'm on my honeymoon.
Ew.
She'll never bug you again.
Coverage! I'm coming in.
Call SWAT team on you.
Bring them on!
Okay, that's...
Just Married. Own the DVD or rent the video today.
Hi, Mom. It's Pee-wee.
Say hi to Pussy for me.
This is Labatt Blue, the clean, crisp lager imported daily from Canada. Its refreshing, honest taste.
Cut. No, I really didn't feel that one. Can we record it again?
Let's get some more blue in there.
Oh, that's good beer.
When it comes to athlete's foot, this is the latest. This isn't. Lotrimon Ultra, the latest prescription-strength medicine available without a prescription. The latest cure, so ultra-powerful, one use a day is all you need. Nothing's proven stronger or faster. Lotrimon Ultra.
Most embarrassing hockey moment would probably be stepping on the ice with skate guards and falling in front of the team and the coach and stuff. And I don't know, it was pretty funny, but got made fun of a little bit for that, but it's over now, yeah. The last book I read was probably on Wayne Gretzky growing up, and it's like, I guess. My favorite TV show I like to watch is probably, I don't want to say a girly TV show, so probably 7th Avenue or something like that. It's pretty, what else is there? I don't know. Well, something a lot of people don't know about me is that I'm a pretty good video game player, and I'm pretty good at NHL 2003 on PlayStation 2.
A few seconds with Nathan Horton, who was the third overall pick of this draft to the Florida Panthers. The next pick belongs to the Boston Bruins, which they acquired from San Jose a few minutes ago. The Sharks got that pick from the Toronto Maple Leafs. The Maple Leafs, one of four teams without a first-round pick in this draft. Colorado, Detroit, and Phoenix are the others. So this is the pick, well-traveled, that was given up by the Maple Leafs to San Jose for Owen Nolan. Time for the Boston Bruins to make their pick. They drop down from 16 to 21. Switching picks with the Edmonton Oilers, here's GM Mike O'Connell.
Prior to our selection, the Boston Bruins would like to congratulate all the young players in attendance and their families and thank them for their dedication to this great game of hockey. Boston selects from Colorado College, Mark Stewart.
Well, this is the native of Rochester, Minnesota, we talked about a few minutes ago. Pretty classic National Hockey League stay-at-home defenseman.
Big, strong, physical, likes to punish with the body, some good bloodlines. His brother Mike was drafted by Nashville in the year 2000. His older brother Colin was also drafted by Atlanta in 2001. So, three of the last 4 years, a member of the Stewart family has been drafted by National Hockey League teams. His dad was the doctor with the U.S. World Junior team, a team that Mark played for in Halifax. And here, this guy's got a lot of upside.
I love this pick by Sean Cody, Mike O'Connell, and the rest of the Boston Bruins hierarchy. This is a player that will play for a very long time in the National Hockey League. He's very smart, comes from a good program at Colorado College, paid his dues coming up. He'll remind you a lot when he's on the offensive blue line of Raymond Bork. He likes to walk the line, he makes great subtle passes. He's not as good a defender as Raymond Bork, but he's a guy that can step up and initiate. This is a tremendous selection by the Boston Bruins, and he will play on a back end with Nicholas Boynton and Hal Gill and Jonathan Girard, a good young mobile defense. And remember, they're going to add Sean Morrison as well. So this is a very good Boston Bruins defense, especially with the addition of Mark Stewart. I love this pick. Good job by the Bruins.
Well, the Boston Bruins have favored a lot of U.S. college players in recent years, and the latest is Mark Stewart from Colorado College. And of course, they've traded for Jeff Gilson from the San Jose Sharks, among others.
They're a defensive-rich team now, and you can build around Joe Thornton, and you can build around Glenn Murray, and you look at Brian Ralston. I mean, they've got some real good players in Boston right now. They're adding skill, and they're adding determination, and they're adding quality.
They just need a coach. Mike Sullivan's supposed to be the guy. Everybody seems to be the worst kept secret in the world that Mike Sullivan will be the coach. But no official announcement yet from the Boston Bruins, and Mike O'Connell said this morning there wouldn't be.
Here's a look at their recent draft history. Jonathan Girard back in 1998. Nick Boynton, who was a re-entry, originally drafted by Washington. Shane Morrison is a guy that a lot of people in hockey are talking about as being a potentially strong NHL player. Here's Dave Strader.
All right, Mike O'Connell, you swap with San Jose, rather, willing to move down. You get a defenseman. You played D as a player in the National Hockey League. What does Mark Stewart bring to your organization?
Well, he's a character kid. Big, as you can see, he's a good-sized kid, wide body, plays very physical, and we're very happy to select him when we did.
You gave coaching a try. You're going to give up the coaching reins. Is Mike Sullivan going to be announced as your new head coach?
Well, we're going to make an announcement on Monday. We'll make two announcements, my retirement and the hiring of a new coach.
What did the coaching experience do for you, though, as far as giving you a look at your team at ice level during practice, during game situations?
Well, it just kind of reintroduced you to the game and how difficult a job it is to be a player and a coach. I mean, it's ultimate respect for the coaches of this league, and
and coaches throughout. But it does give you a chance to see the players and how they react to some difficult situations and how they handle the traffic and if they can or if they can't.
Mike, we appreciate this. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Gord?
All right, thanks very much, Dave. So Mark Stewart puts on the black and gold of the Boston Bruins. And here are the best available picks according to Bob McKenzie's TSN ranking. Number 13 is Marc-Antoine Fleury. The next pick belongs to the Edmonton Oilers. They moved down in a swap of picks with the New Jersey Devils. They've had some success in Quebec. Alex Hemsky, a player they got from the Hull Olympics, terrific for them this year. Will that be a nice fit?
Fleury's got some upside. He can score some goals. He can create some offense, a good playmaker. Be a good pick for Edmonton at this point in the draft. A guy who's really slid. A lot of people thought would have a chance of cracking the top 10.
The Oilers really like guys that can skate, and that's one of the things I think to watch for. It's an intangible in this pick by Kevin Lowe.
On behalf of the Edmonton Oilers organization, I'd like to thank David Poile and the Nashville Predators for a wonderful weekend. I'd also like to invite hockey fans all over the world to tune in this November 22nd as the Edmonton Oilers will play the NHL's first ever outdoor hockey game against the Montreal Canadiens. Thank you very much.
The Edmonton Oilers are proud to select from the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, Rimouski, Oceanic, Marc-Antoine Pouliot.
Kevin Prendergast makes the pick for the Edmonton Oilers. You know, sometimes guys get overlooked because they play on very poor junior teams. That happened to Paul Coffey when he was picked by the Edmonton Oilers more than 20 years ago. Marc-Antoine Pouliot played on a Rimouski team that was not very competitive.
I can only tell you this, good player, bad team, and the more of the scouts that I talk to like Pouliot better than they like Steve Bernier of the Moncton Wildcats, even though Steve Bernier had much better numbers than Pouliot. A lot of them have thought that Pouliot's overall play was going to be better at the National Hockey League level, would translate a little better. He didn't put up as many goals as Steve Bernier's 49, but Pouliot still scored a respectable 32 goals and 73 points, 100 penalty minutes, more of an all-round player than Bernier, who's a little more one-dimensional. But because the team stepped up and liked Bernier and took him a little bit higher, Pouliot slipped, and the Edmonton Oilers grab him, and he can skate.
But again, there you go, Bob. That's the one intangible. Edmonton always drafts guys that can skate, especially early on in the draft. It's a huge component as to why they're successful.
I wonder how he plays outdoors.
I don't think he'll find out this year.
Fans in Nashville are kind of taken aback when Kevin Lowe announced they're going to play an outdoor game in Edmonton, because that's something you wouldn't likely see here in Tennessee in November.
I don't think we can say enough about the Oilers scouting staff. They've really positioned themselves to be a strong team for a long period of time. Kevin Prendergast, Scott Helsen, their scouting staff have identified a lot of good young players, and they're really strong for the future.
It was not a strength for them for a long time. They're about 10 years for the Oilers, about 87 to 97, when their system did not come up with a lot of prospects.
All I can think about is a Steve Kelly, Shane Doan situation in Edmonton when they pick Steve Kelly and they pass on the local guy, Shane Doan, and all the boos in at that time, the Northlands Coliseum, but I think they've turned the corner on that.
So Marc-Antoine Pouliot is the pick by the Edmonton Oilers. He is selected 22nd overall by Edmonton, and that takes care, Bob, of most of your top picks. The top 16 are now gone. And here's a look at the Oilers' first-round history of late. Jesse Ninnimäki was a real off-the-board pick last year. He had a good year in Finland. Alex Hemsky from Hull in 2001 has really come on this year. It was a major reason the Oilers were able to move Anson Carter to the New York Rangers.
And remember, the Edmonton Oilers split their farm team this year.
All right, let's send you down to Dave Strader.
All right, Kevin Lowe, the guys were saying Marc-Antoine didn't play on a particularly good junior team. Maybe that's why he was overlooked by some other clubs ahead of you.
Yeah, he had a lot of tough nights. I think they went 35 games without a win, but over in the under-18, he played remarkably well, and he's a big centerman with some skill, offensive skill that we really needed.
How far down the road do you project him being in an Edmonton Oiler uniform? That's always the tough question, isn't it?
It is, yeah, but you know, we give young guys a chance out in Edmonton, so it's tough to say, but we're awfully happy to have some skill in the middle.
Real quickly, I heard you promote the outdoor game. You're not usually promoting one game that far down the road, but it should be an exciting night in Edmonton.
Well, the fans, hockey fans all over North America are going to be treated to what a lot of people would have thought if it would have existed at this point was an outdoor NHL game, but it'll be on November 22nd, and we're particularly pleased to have it at Commonwealth Stadium to play against the Montreal Canadiens.
All right, thanks very much, Kevin.
Yeah, thank you.
Gordon?
Next pick belongs to the Vancouver Canucks. Guess who's available? Jeff Tambellini, whose dad just happens to work for the Canucks. Will he be picked? We'll find out in a moment.
How'd you know I don't need that card?
I've been looking at your hand.
Well, that's smart.
No, that's cheating. Using 1010-220. Now that's smart.
No fees, no commitments. Dial 1010-220. The smart way to make inexpensive phone calls.
Lousy cards.
Fill your glasses for a toast.
Champagne?
Good move. A quality beer drinker doesn't compromise a Samuel Adams lager. Always a good decision.
He's just a kid. He's a savior. He's a celebrity. He's a target. He's a rookie. He's a millionaire. He's got the life. LeBron James, The Life, 8 p.m. Tuesday on ESPN.
It's The Life.
One American band defined a season, a lifestyle, and a nation. The Beach Boys are the sounds of summer. For the first time ever, 30 unforgettable Beach Boys hits on one CD. Sounds of Summer is available now in this must-have collection. Sounds of Summer is the very best of the Beach Boys. Fun, 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 till the night takes a tear. 30 unforgettable hits. The soundtrack to your endless summer. To order Sounds of Summer, the very best of the Beach Boys, call the number on your screen or send $18.98 plus $4.95 shipping and handling to the address shown. Call now for rush delivery and let the Beach Boys make your summer the best ever.
If I could meet anyone in the world, it'd be Tim McGraw. Great music, good. Seems like a good guy. Just seems like a fun person to meet.
Something a lot of people wouldn't know is that pretty good tennis player. Played tennis all the time back home, and also listened to a lot of country music. The best prank that was we were out at the Lake Placid World Junior Tryouts, and our goalie on the team called another player on our team, said he was a scout for some team, and asked him to come downstairs and meet him. So everyone's down there meeting him. And our whole team was all there waiting for him to come down. Everyone's just dying laughing. The kids all dressed up, ready to go. It was pretty funny.
Lou Lamorello's New Jersey Devil selected Zach Parise, who loves Tim McGraw, who lives about a 3 wood from this arena here in Nashville, Tennessee. Lamorello's work is done, but the Vancouver Canucks are up next with a 23rd selection in the draft.
The Vancouver Canucks would like to extend our condolences to the family of Roger Nielsen, who coached our team. We would also like to thank the Nashville Predators and the city of Nashville for such a lovely reception. And now, on behalf of all of our fans in Manitoba and in beautiful British Columbia, we are pleased to announce our selection from Ohio State University and the CCHA, Ryan Kesler.
Second time in three years, that the Vancouver Canucks have gone to Ohio State University for the first round pick. 2 years ago, they took defenseman R.J. Umberger from the Buckeyes. Now it's Ryan Kesler, a player who played for the U.S. at the World Junior Hockey Championship and played, what would you say, very solidly?
He's going to be a very good player. He's got tremendous skater. He's got great defensive awareness. He goes to the net extremely hard. Very underrated offensive potential. But the big thing is he's a physical guy that gets up and down the rink in a hurry, and that's going to make him a dynamic NHL player. I don't think he'll play as a first line or a second line player, but he will be a great third line player in the league, Bob.
Yeah, the one word that describes this guy is solid. Solid in every single area. No weaknesses, like you said, Pierre. A strong, powerful skater. Not going to put a lot of points on the board, or not expected to put a lot of points on the board at the National Hockey League level, but a guy with character and grit and strength. And it's interesting that 2 of 3 years, as you point out, Gord, the Vancouver Canucks have gone to Ohio State University 2 years ago for R.J. Umberger and this year for Ryan Kesler.
Anyone surprised that the Canucks wouldn't take Jeff Tambellini? We talked about Zach Parise earlier. His dad doesn't work for the team. That's a different situation. Jeff Tamalini's dad works for the Canucks. That could be an uncomfortable situation.
It could be. The other part of it is, you know, Steve Tamalini, you never know, maybe leaving the Vancouver Canucks to go work somewhere else. So you just don't want to get caught in that situation. And that's not to disparage the work that Jeff Tamalini did at the University of Michigan. But I think that if you really were rating the players, you'd rate this player, Kessler, ahead of Tamalini.
And you've got to let the scouts do their job. You pay the scouts to go out, and you can't let family things get in. And if they think Kessler's a better player than Tamalini, then they have to go ahead and take him.
Bob, exactly. You had Kessler rated 19th and Tamalini 20th, so they're right in that neighborhood. The Canucks picking 23rd select Ryan Kessler. He was a guy at the World Junior Tournament, to be honest with you, who looked more like a pro than a lot of the other guys there.
That's exactly what I like about him, and I think Brian Burke and his staff deserve a lot of credit. I think this guy's going to be a very, very good player for a long period of time because of his speed. He's a good-sized guy that can really skate.
Well, there's still some of those available. Anthony Stewart, TSN's 21st ranked player, still available. European Lazchev, pretty good offensive player. We ranked him number 17. He still hasn't gone. So it'll be interesting to see what comes up next. And I believe the Philadelphia Flyers are picking next. Flyers picking next.
Yes, the Philadelphia Flyers have the 24th pick. But first of all, the Vancouver Canucks. Recent history, you know, of course, about the Sedins going second and third overall in 1999, 2000, Nathan Smith, R.J. Emberger from Ohio State, and then last year, Kirill Koltsov. Here's Dave Strader.
All right, Brian Burke, general manager. Even in a deep draft, it gets harder to handicap as you get later in the first round. Why did Ryan Kessler jump out at you guys?
When we watched him play, he reminded us of a young Trevor Linden in terms of his intensity and skating ability and hitting. We felt very strongly that if he was there, we had any kind of a shot at him, we were going to take him. We're really pleased with it.
With Steve Tamalini in the organization and his son available, was that a temptation or was that something you were going to try to stay away from?
No, well, what I told our scouts is pretend his name is John Smith. You know, pretend his name is some other person besides Steve Tamalini for two reasons. One, we've got to take the best player available. That's our philosophy. And two, there's no guarantee that Steve Tamalini is going to be in our organization. He's been a candidate for a couple of GM jobs elsewhere, so we're not the list.
All right, Brian, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Gordon. There's Brian Burke making the point that we talked about earlier that you don't draft for family reasons.
No, absolutely not.
And it's different than the Zach Parise situation because JP Parise doesn't work for the team. The next pick is Philadelphia.
Mike Richards.
Mike Richards won the Memorial Cup with the Kitchener Rangers, a powerhouse junior team, and he was a key player for them.
Mike Richards put up terrific numbers this year, second year in the Ontario Hockey League. 37 goals, 87 points in 67 games, but more importantly, played a strong two-way game, especially in the playoffs. Head coach Pete DeBoer of the Kitchener Rangers challenged Richards to go up against the top offensive players throughout the playoffs. He did a great job of shutting down the top player, much like John Madden did for the New Jersey Devils, but he also put up significant points along the way from Kenora, Ontario, a big, strong kid with some great ability. And you know, the Kitchener Ranger organization, Pete DeBoer, Steve Spott, those people, they know Stephen Weiss pretty well because they had him when they were as part of the Plymouth Whalers. And Steve Spott is the uncle of Stephen Weiss. There's a lot of favorable comparisons in terms of where they are at their development stage. Not necessarily they're the same type of players because this guy's a much harder player than Stephen Weiss. And Stephen Weiss is probably more of a finesse player. But just where they are in terms of their development, this guy's terrific.
You know, I love it when you get players that play with other good players. And this kid played with Derek Roy. He played with Gregory Campbell. He played with Steve Emminger. He won a Memorial Cup. Practice habits are impeccable. Pete DeBoer is one of the best young coaches in hockey right now. He will coach in the NHL someday. This is a phenomenal pick, and it's a smart pick.
And I can tell you this right now. If Dion Phaneuf had not been available at number 9 overall for the Calgary Flames, this is the guy they were going to take at number 9. They were going to go off the board. They liked this guy so much. Out of all the forwards available from the number 9 spot to now, Calgary had this guy rated very highly.
Part of taking players in the draft is taking them from quality organizations. We saw it for years with the Kamloops Blazers. We're seeing it now with the Kitchener Rangers. You get kids that come from quality programs, they're coming into you, half the battle's already won for them.
Second first round pick of this 2003 draft for the Philadelphia Flyers. Richards is selected, and the next pick belongs to the Tampa Bay Lightning. Back with that after this.
When athletes sweat, they lose more than just water. Gatorade puts back sodium and potassium, proven to replenish and rehydrate athletes better than water. Gatorade, is it in you?
years ago, a groundbreaking character brought comic book fantasy to a whole new level. This summer, visionary director Ang Lee takes blockbuster filmmaking into a brave new world, and there is no going back.
My Bruce.
Two thumbs up. The Hulk. Rated PG-13. Now playing.
Feeling overwhelmed by current events? Don't turn to drugs and alcohol.
Hey, how was your run?
Great.
Substance abuse is not the way to manage life. If you or someone you know needs information or treatment referral, call 1-800-662-HELP.
My nickname, they call me Suits. That's really all. Nothing special, just Suits. Well, when I'm not at the rink, I try to golf, you know. I'm not very good at golf, and just hang out with the family and stuff. If I could play with any NHLer, it'd probably be my uncle, Gary. He always liked playing, liked the way he played, you know, and I've always wanted to. I think that'd be pretty neat to play with the family.
Ryan Suter selected by Nashville. 10 first-round picks have already been dealt. We understand another one is on the move. Here's the commissioner, Gary Bettman.
There's another trade to announce. The Tampa Bay Lightning trade the number 25 pick, the 25th pick in this year's draft, to Florida in exchange for Florida's picks number 34, 41, and 192. All in this year's draft. Next selection will be made by the Florida Panthers with the 25th pick in the draft.
So Rick Dudley, who began the day with the deal to send the first round pick to the first overall pick to the Pittsburgh Penguins, now deals for the number 25 selection in the draft with his old organization, the Tampa Bay Lightning. He sends 2 seconds and a very late pick. The 192nd pick is a sixth round pick, which originally, believe it or not, belong to the Florida Panthers. They get it back from the Tampa Bay Lightning.
If they want a Mike Keenan type hockey player, they could get Anthony Stewart to go along with Nathan Horton. Those two will be linked for some time. They not only have the same agent in Bobby Orr, but Stewart broke Horton's jaw in a fight this season.
And they're good buddies, though. They're real good friends.
It was a fascinating story because Stewart and Horton were great friends. Stewart broke Horton's jaw, denied Horton a chance to go to the National Junior Training Camp. And of course, we told you the story about Stewart earlier. Bob, you had him ranked right about this spot. He's ranked 21st. This is the 25th pick in the draft. We'll see if maybe the Florida Panthers grab them both.
This is a Mike Keenan type player too if they get him, boy. I'll tell you what. You wouldn't want to be a defenseman on the opposition team now with Horton, and if in fact Stewart goes there, forecheck game will be huge.
Florida selects from the Kingston Frontenacs, Anthony Stewart.
How about that? How about that, huh? Two great friends involved in one of the defining moments in this year's junior hockey season, and now they've been drafted by the same organization. And we told you earlier the story of Anthony Stewart. Few players in this room have climbed over more obstacles than Anthony Stewart to get to this point.
Terrific skater, huge size. They list him at 6'1", 239, and he is all of that, if not taller.
And it's all muscle.
He can lean on people.
And a decent goal scorer as well. Like many of the first round picks from the Canadian Hockey League, 32 goals, 70 points, averaging a point a game for the Kingston Frontenacs. I think the only disappointment in the Stewart household today is that he wasn't drafted by the Montreal Canadiens, because as we said before, his dad Norman absolutely loves the Habs. He's passionate about them.
You know what? Florida's not a bad second choice. I got news for you. A lot of parents like it when their kids get taken by the Florida Panthers.
Again, it goes to what the Florida Panthers wanted to address, so get more of a North American flavor to their lineup, and that's exactly what they've done today so far with Nathan Horton going over as the third pick overall, and obviously what we've just seen right here.
Stewart, by the way, was profiled in a local paper yesterday and received a nice hand from the crowd here. We should pay tribute again to this crowd in Nashville, which has stayed here for most of the first round. It has been quite raucous, quite a contrast from last year's draft in Toronto.
Funny, Anthony Stewart played for the North York Canadiens organization in the Greater Toronto Hockey League. He's the second member of that organization to be drafted. A lot of people thought he would have been the first guy out of that graduates from that organization to go in today's first round, but Brent Burns was a teammate of his on those North York Canadian teams, even though Brent Burns is from Barrie, Ontario. Anthony Stewart, as we showed in the feature off the top, grew up in tough surroundings in Scarborough, Ontario. Took the bus to a lot of his hockey games. When he couldn't get the bus to his hockey games, he walked to a lot of his hockey games. In blizzards, this guy carried his hockey bag and walked miles to get to the rink because that was the only way he was going to get there in the early days. So overcome some tough odds. Anthony Stewart, a great pick for the Florida Panthers.
And Pierre, as a former scout, when you look at something like that, you like it.
Oh, I just can't say enough good things about it. I mean, I'm emotional right now watching because that guy really wants to be here. And he wants to be a player. And he wants to be a player for all the right reasons. And it's a tremendous day for obviously Anthony Stewart and for his family. But I think it's a great day for the Florida Panthers as well.
Stewart and Horton are the picks. And let's hear from Mr. Stewart as with our Dave Strader.
All right, Anthony, the guys have been saying all along how many obstacles you overcame to get here. What's been the biggest factor in you getting to this point in your hockey career and in your life?
Just support from family and friends. I had a lot of support along the way, and can't really explain the feeling I have right now. I've made a lot of people proud, and I'm just happy to be here and be a part of Florida's organization.
Obviously, you played against a good friend, Nathan Horton. You guys were involved in a little tussle that changed the junior landscape earlier in the season. Now you're teammates.
It's great. Me and Horton are best friends. Right now, and it's just great to be on the same team as him, and I'm looking forward to training camp with him.
Anthony, congratulations.
Yeah, thank you very much.
All right. Gordon?
All right, the Stewart family celebrates. What a great moment for that family.
Yeah, that's great.
Norman's a real character.
That's great.
Anthony Stewart talking to Willie O'Ree, the head of the NHL Diversity Task Force down there on the floor of the NHL Draft. Well, here's the top players still available, Bob. According to you, Konstantin Glazachev leads the list.
Keep an eye on this Brian Boyle kid. He's almost 6'7" from St. Sebastian's, a prep school in Boston. He's going to Boston College next year. I know that he's highly thought of by a lot of teams that are picking in the balance of this first round. Also, an interesting story on Patrick O'Sullivan. We'll have a little more time for that when he's selected or at some point in the show. Tambellini, a little on the small side, but a great skater, put up great numbers for the University of Michigan. And Konstantin Glazachev, who is a great offensive hockey player, but also a little inconsistent, described by the Red Line Report, a top-notch scouting service, as the worst diver in the national hockey available in this year's NHL draft.
Now, the LA Kings have the next two picks in the draft. Don't forget, they've already made one of them. They drafted 13th. Now they've got the next two in this draft. They got this one, the 26th pick from the Colorado Avalanche, the second first-round pick they acquired in the Rob Blake trade, the 27th pick they got from the Detroit Red Wings in the Matthew Schneider deal. So the LA Kings with three first-round picks this year with the 13th selection. Of course, they took Dustin Brown from the Guelph Storm of the Ontario Hockey League. So now Dave Taylor and Andy Murray talking over. But what a luxury for the Kings to have the next two picks in the draft.
We mentioned Andy Murray, the head coach of the Los Angeles Kings. An exciting day for him because his son Brady is expected to be drafted. Where he goes could be third round, could be fourth round. But an exciting day when a head coach of the National Hockey League gets an opportunity to see his son drafted at some point today.
That's Greg Dressel in the middle of your screen. He's a guy that does a lot of scouting for them in the eastern part of the United States, in particular American colleges and prep schools. And Bob talked about Brian Boyle and the potential there. And Greg Dressel is the guy talking to Dave Taylor right now. Al Murray's in the middle. So maybe they are going to go and take Brian Boyle.
They're running out of time to make the pick, but Al Murray is now up. And I believe the Kings will make their second first-round pick of this draft. They better hurry. We have to call a timeout here.
And that's Billy O'Flaherty, who also scouts the eastern part of the United States. There's Andy Murray, the coach.
Wonder where his son will be drafted. Maybe the Los Angeles Kings. See, lots of father-son things going here today.
You know, we talked about Zach Parise. That's who Andy Murray's son played with at Shattuck St. Mary's.
Taylor is on the phone. Murray was up with the sweater, and Gary Bettman has told them to either make the pick or call timeout. And you see
Kevin Gilmore in the back.
Time is called by the Kings. We will call time as well and take some time to reflect on some of the great days for families here at the draft. Our coverage of the 2003 entry draft continues from Nashville right after this.
Jay.
So don't tell me who to love. You have no idea how I feel. Excuse me.
leaving.
Sensational play.
What?
They're down by 10 at the half. Now they come.
If the last thing you want to do is get married.
Welcome to the family. You can call me Pussy now.
Pussy?
You know, like a cat.
Then bring home Just Married on DVD for your girlfriend.
I'm on my honeymoon?
Ew.
She'll never bug you again.
Coverage, coverage, coverage!
I'm coming in!
He calls SWAT team on you!
Bring him on!
Okay, that's...
Just Married. Own the DVD or rent the video today.
Hi, Mom. It's Pee-wee.
Say hi to Pussy for me.
I was nervous.
I need to go to the men's room. You want to come with me?
Sure.
Your hair looks great tonight.
Thanks, just got it done.
You're not a woman. Why use a woman shampoo? Try new Suave for Men. Cleans just as good as her brand for less.
Inside's the difference.
It's what's inside that makes the difference. Between just handling the road...
attacking.
...and scorching the pavement. Between just moving and riding curves like you're on rails. Between just going and tearing the wind in half. The 227 horsepower, turbocharged, all-wheel drive Subaru WRX. Subaru, driven by what's inside.
Latin Fury, live from Puerto Rico. Undefeated sensation Miguel Cotto. WBO junior middleweight champion Daniel Santos. And WBA flyweight champion Eric Morrell. Contact your pay-per-view provider to order.
A lot of people might not know about me is probably just the fact that I do play pretty much every sport. I grew up playing baseball, football, basketball, volleyball, and I've been to nationals in baseball and been to the finals in football and stuff. So I've been through a lot of different sports events, and it's been a blast. Most embarrassing hockey moment would probably be last year. I tried on a pair of skates and he didn't tell me there wasn't any blades on the bottom, it was just the holders. Then I went on the ice and I fell down and it was all in the newspaper and stuff, so it was pretty funny.
Ryan Murray of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim selected Ryan Getzlaf in this draft with the 19th overall selection. Their crosstown rivals, the LA Kings, have the next two picks at 26 and 27. And we understand that the Kings have settled on their man. The number 26 pick. Hang on. Well, they had decided, and now they've changed their mind.
Well, interesting to see Greg Dreschel up there, who is their Eastern scout, as we said earlier, does a lot of college and also high school and prep school scouting. So I'm not surprised if, in fact, as Bob said, it's Brian Boyle.
Now,
a little conversation going on between the Montreal Canadiens. Andre Savard talking to Dave Taylor and Al Murray.
That's Trevor Timmins, who's a director.
Well, you've got the next pick as well, so
could be the next pick. Yeah.
Here's Al Murray with the sweater or the pick.
Los Angeles Kings select from St. Sebastian's High School, Brian Boyle.
6'7", one of 13 kids.
Actually, Gordon, he's only 6'6¾".
Oh, sorry. Pardon me. He is one of 13 kids.
Well, he is that big. But one of the things he's going to have to do when he goes to Boston College next season is he's going to have to play big. He doesn't play real big right now. He dominates in his league in the Boston area because he's just so much more skilled and so much bigger than the other kids. But he doesn't lean on people. And that's one of the reasons why he slid so far down. He's going to have to start leaning on people if he's going to be the NHL player that a lot of people are hoping that he will be.
This guy is the very definition of a project in the National Hockey League. We point out anybody who's that tall, coming out of a program like St. Sebastian's, playing prep school hockey, to go in the first round ahead of a lot of players who played at a much higher level. The expectation on the part of Los Angeles Kings is you take this guy and you put him in Boston College and you just leave him alone and let him develop and let him naturally get stronger and get used to the size that the growth spurt that he's gone through. There's a certain awkwardness that comes with being almost 6'7" and being only 18 years old. It's going to take time for him to grow into his body, if you will, and a proud day for the Boyles from Dorchester, Mass.
Dorchester is one tough village, too. I'll tell you what, they can get after you in Dorchester.
Well, I remember hearing about a guy who was 6'9", who was going to be something of a project, and Zdeno Chara turned out to be not a bad National Hockey League defenseman, and Hal Gill, of course, in Boston at 6'7" has been pretty good
and
as well.
It's happy time for the Boyle family right now. His father was diagnosed a while back with cancer. He's now being declared cancer-free. So lots to celebrate for the Boyle family from the Boston area.
And I like the fact that he's going to Boston College, which has done such a good job developing players over time. You know, and Colby Baker, we saw Brian Johnta play so well for the New Jersey Devils, who spent a lot of time at Boston College. Jerry York does a great job, along with Mike Cavanaugh, their assistant coach, in finding players and developing them. So they're going in the right direction, the LA Kings, for this pick.
That hat going to be big enough?
Yeah, look at that. Holy man. It's the NHL draft, not the NBA draft.
Now, it's interesting. Did the Kings come back with their next pick, or was that little conversation we saw between Dave Taylor and Andre Savard a shadow of things to come here, possibly with the Montreal Canadiens jumping up and making a trade?
That's the Kings' second first-round pick of this draft. You see the Boyles make their way down. So here, Bob, are your best available picks. Now, we've gone through 26. Only five of your top 30 remain available. Glazachev, the Russian, is the top one, followed by Jeff Tambellini.
Some question marks with each of these guys. Glazachev is highly inconsistent. Tambellini's not a real big guy. Frischie's had some problems with his shoulders, but he's lots of potential for that player from Sarnia. Patrick O'Sullivan, a very high scorer, but lots of issues in terms of some problems that he's gone through on the family front. Corey Perry, a guy from Peterborough who played for the London Knights, had a great rookie season in the OHL. Not so good, although he came out at the end of the year. So all these players have the potential to go in this last part of the first round. But there are also other guys out there that are possibilities to jump up and go past them.
Now the Kings are taking a look at what else is available.
Some good Europeans out there still haven't been taken. Wojtek Polak is a guy from the Czech Republic. Here's a guy, a big winger, who can score some goals. He's a possibility.
Well, the Kings really loaded up on first-round picks this year. We mentioned they had a tough year, but LA had a year that was not indicative of the talent level that the Kings have. They had real problems with injuries. They've got an excellent core of really good young players.
The one question mark is going to be in goal. They went out and got Roman Čechmánek, and we saw what he did. He pulled a disappearing act in the playoffs this season for the Philadelphia Flyers. That's why he was traded away. So you got to look at the LA Kings and wonder where they're going to go.
Why is Andy Murray smiling so much? This wouldn't be a young Murray being
smiling. No, not yet.
No, too early.
Not yet, too early. But he'd be happy to see his son taken by the Los Angeles Kings.
That's Robbie Laird, who's their pro scout.
You know why he's smiling? He just saw a 6'7" defenseman. That's why he's smiling.
Pierre, if you see Robbie Laird, the pro scout, in there, maybe they're talking about
trade. They're talking trade. That's exactly right.
The Kings with the next pick as well. Our live coverage of the 2003 entry draft continues from Nashville right after that.
On DVD June 24th. He was the one cop.
You gotta be heartless in my line of work.
No one dared to take on. Kurt Russell in the first great movie of 2003. Dark Blue on DVD June 24th.
Fred Couples and ESPN are searching for America's best amateur twosome in the ESPN National Golf Challenge. Participate in June at a course near you and qualify for the championship in Simi Valley July 15th. To register, log on to ESPNGolf.com.
This summer, ESPN2 invites you to the hottest block party around. Kick it on Friday nights with host Mos Def for sports and more. ESPN2's Block Party, presented by Dodge. Friday nights at 7, all summer long.
There's one tournament where the competition isn't among men and women, but rather gentlemen and ladies. And the tradition of 125 years makes this slam the grandest of them all. Wimbledon 2003 begins Monday on ESPN2.
Bringing DirecTV to our new house was real easy. We just called ahead, left the old dish where it was, and packed the receiver and remote. They gave us a new dish and even took care of the installation. Actually, DirecTV made moving an enjoyable experience.
Now it's my turn to enjoy it. Here you go. Remember to lift with your knees, dear.
Saturday and every Saturday, new hit movies premiere only on Stars, premiering this Saturday.
I can tell you the license plate numbers of all six cars outside. I can tell you that our waitress is left-handed and the guy sitting up at the counter knows how to handle himself. And at this altitude, I can run flat out for a half mile before my hands start shaking. How can I know that and not know who I am?
The Bourne Identity. Premiering this Saturday on Stars. Stars is one of 12 distinct channels in the Stars Super Pack on DirecTV.
Back here in Nashville, the LA Kings have been busy. Their third first-round pick of this draft, set now from Al Murray.
Los Angeles Kings select from the University of Michigan, Jeff Tambellini.
There it is, Jeff Tambellini, the son of former NHLer Steve, now an executive with the Vancouver Canucks. You see Lanny McDonald standing there. McDonald and Tambellini, former teammates of the Calgary Flames, are great friends. You can sum up Jeff Tambellini in one sentence. He's a world-class skater.
Absolutely, and he comes by that naturally because Steve Tambellini was a great skater, and so was Addie Tambellini. Addie Tambellini is Jeff's grandfather, and he played for the Trail Smoke Eaters when they won the world championship back in the early 60s.
This goes back to taking kids that come from great programs. This kid was a great player in BC before he went to the University of Michigan. Now he's playing for Red Berenson, and Eric Nystrom got drafted in the first round last year out of the University of Michigan. Now it's Steve Tambellini this season, or Jeff Tambellini, excuse me. But the biggest thing of all, Gord touched on it, the skating ability of this young man. He's going to open up a lot of chances for himself at the NHL level because he can really break free from traffic.
The first rookie from the Wolverines to lead the team in scoring since Mike Comrie in 98-99. So he put up good numbers in his freshman year, 26 goals, 45 points in just 43 games. University of Michigan getting to the Frozen Four, losing in overtime to Thomas Vanek.
At Minnesota. It's worth pointing out, too, that Family Day continues here. Ryan Suter, the son of Bob, nephew of Gary, drafted. Robert Nielsen, there's Steve Tambellini, father of Jeff. Robert Nielsen, Kent Nielsen's son, drafted. Zach Parise, the son of J.P. Parise, drafted in the first round. And now, Jeff Tambellini. So, you know what? I think if you're Steve Tambellini, you're happy.
Absolutely.
You know what? You don't want your son with your team. It can be awkward. And at least you're in the same conference.
And as Brian Burke said, you never know. Steve Tambellini may not be with the Vancouver Canucks much longer.
Boy, can this guy fly. Like when you watch him skate, it's really something special.
And that's what we were talking about. He may not be the biggest guy, but a lot like Zach Parise, he opens up a lot of room for himself because of his sheer skill level.
And right back to Rick goes Steve Tambellini with the Canucks. Back on the phone to the son was drafted. Let's go down to Dave Strader.
All right, Jeff, got to be a proud day for your dad. There was some speculation you might go to his team, but you're an LA King.
Oh, I can't. I'm so excited. You know, this is a dream come true, and just to go in the first round, it's amazing.
You come from a program that sent a lot of guys to the National Hockey League. They've won championships. Talk a little bit about how Red Berenson and that University of Michigan program prepares you for the NHL.
He's been awesome. He's developed me so well last year, and I'm pretty excited to go to get to play with another LA King, Mike Camilleri.
All right, Jeff, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Gord?
I don't think Steve Tambellini's talking trade. I think he's talking to somebody in the family. He's taking a couple of moments off the Vancouver table to talk to somebody in his family.
Well, Maddie's not here. He's on the phone.
He's talking to Grandpa Pa right now.
That's exactly it. Next pick belongs to the Dallas Stars.
You know what, Gord?
Their GM Doug Armstrong is on the phone.
These guys know how to get it done, too, though, when it comes to drafting. Les Jackson, Timmy Bernhardt, Doug Armstrong, they do a great job in identifying talent.
You talk about father and son combinations. Doug Armstrong's dad, Neil, a longtime NHL official.
Member of the Hockey Hall of Fame.
Yeah, and was a longtime scout for the Montreal Canadiens.
And a very good one.
Keep an eye on the Dallas Stars this offseason. Who knows what's to become of this team? They've got to slash as much as maybe $50 million in payroll. And any name has been mentioned. We've even heard Mike Modano's name in trade rumors. I find it very hard to believe that the Dallas Stars would do that. Bill Guerin's name pops up. Stu Barnes, Jason Arnott, Daryl Sador, Richard Matvichuk. There is a cost-cutting going on in Dallas in a big way, and there are going to be some bodies flying out the door if they can find a market for them.
But you know, you talk about cost-cutting. One of the things they've got to do is they've got to get Darian Hatcher signed before July 1st, or he's going to become an unrestricted free agent, and that's a huge issue for that.
To my knowledge, they haven't even spoken about a contract because they're so intent right now on trying to move hockey players out and trying to bring the salary down enough that they can afford to sign Darian Hatcher. That's a huge issue.
And that's Guy Carbonneau sitting to the right of Doug Armstrong. Guy Carbonneau was being rumored as a potential candidate to be the head coach for the Montreal Canadiens. That's not going to happen. Bob Gainey endorsed, at least this season, Bob Gainey endorsed Claude Julien to go back with the Montreal Canadiens. So Guy Carbonneau is going to be back with the Dallas Stars next year. Gary Mahar right there from the NHL has done such a good job for them for so many years.
In the foreground, you can see them. This is a deal, obviously, between Dallas and Anaheim. That's Chuck Fletcher on the right for the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. And the assistant general manager of the Dallas Stars, Francois Giguère, is there. Not to be confused with Francois Allaire, the goaltending coach of the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, or J.S. Giguère, the goaltender for the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. There's Jim Leitz. All right, let's go to Gary. Oh,
the Dallas Stars trade the number 28 pick to the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim in exchange for Anaheim's picks number 36 and 54 in this year's draft. The Mighty Ducks of Anaheim have the 28th pick. You're up next.
Anaheim had 2 second-round picks, have moved them to the Dallas Stars for the Stars' first-round pick in this draft. This has been a long-time Dallas philosophy. Dallas has often traded down to gather extra picks.
But you know what else this shows is the depth of this draft. We've seen a lot of teams trading down and getting more picks or getting better picks. And the big reason why is there's a lot of quality depth in this
draft. The 36th pick is only 8 picks from now, so the Stars are going to get the guy they want.
Bottom line is the Stars would like two swings at the bat, 36th and 54th rather than 28th, and the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim obviously see a player still on the board that they would like to get.
So the Ducks await the arrival of the sweater, and they'll make their second first round selection.
Well, if it's an offensive player you want, there are some on the board. Glazachev has yet to be taken. O'Sullivan yet to be taken. And Corey Perry of the London Knights yet to be taken. Danny Fritchie from the Sarnia Sting. All guys that can put the puck in the net with offensive upside. That may well be the way the Ducks are, what direction they're going in here with this pick.
Bob, you brought up Corey Perry coming from Mark Hunter's London Knights. I mean, you know he's been well-schooled in both facets of the game, both offense and defense. And remember, Brian Murray coached Dale Hunter down in Washington, so he's very familiar with the Hunter family.
Well, the scouts have gone, and here they come. So Commissioner Gary Bettman announces yet another first-round pick dealt. That's 12, by my count, that have been juggled around in this year's first round.
Corey Perry.
So there's the Brian Murray, Dale Hunter connection, and Corey Perry of the London Knights becomes the pick with the 28th selection in this draft, the second first-round pick by the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim in this draft.
A native of Peterborough, Ontario, a very good team up there, coached by Mark Vittorelli. And Corey Perry was a phenom in his first year in the Ontario Hockey League, scored 28 goals in 60 games, and that's unusual for a 16-year-old to step in and do that, but he really experienced a sophomore jinx, only scored 25 goals in his second season. It was a major disappointment this season, and a lot of people started to put question marks all over this kid, but a better second half and a very strong playoff reestablished himself as a potential first-round pick, a guy who's going right where everybody expected that he would have a shot to go, Pierre.
Bob, part of the reason he had that bang-up first year is the fact he played with Rick Nash, and we all know that playing with a star player like that's going to really help you break into the OHL.
And you saw him shaking hands there. There's Mark Hunter on the right,
exactly.
Dale Hunter in the middle.
Yep.
So the
Hunter clan
London Knights
right
group congratulating him.
But there wasn't the same kind of insulation, obviously, this year in London. There was no Rick Nash, so this guy had to do a lot on his own. The fact he was able to bounce back really says a lot about, I think, the ability of this young man. Being congratulated there by the people from Newport Sports Management, Don Meehan, Craig Oster, Wade Arnott, Patrick Morris.
So Corey Perry, Bob, you had him 29th in this draft, and he goes 28th. He jumped way up.
Peterborough Minor Hockey System does a great job of developing talent.
Yeah, well,
and think about Roger Nielsen again.
Yeah, that's and the next pick, by the way, belongs to the Ottawa Senators, and with heavy hearts, they'll make that selection. But for the Perry family, this is a great day. And they've been drafted by an organization that has made a commitment to young players, despite the appearance of the Stanley Cup Final. I mean, this isn't like the Ducks did it with a bunch of older guys. A couple of guys, Adam Oates and Steve Thomas, were, but the core of that team is pretty young.
I love it, especially on defense, Gordon. When you look at it, Kurt Sauer was a free agent coming out of Spokane, and then you look at Ruslan Slay on defense. They've got so many good young players in that organization. I think Stanislav Chistov would be one of the greater impact players in this league, and he's still a young guy.
Corey Perry is the selection of Anaheim, and the next pick belongs to the Ottawa Senators. On a tough day for them, and a tough day for all of us who love Roger Nielsen and the game of hockey.
He's just a kid.
I'm for going to college, and I will be entering the NBA draft.
He's a savior.
The first pick in the NBA draft goes to...
He's a celebrity. He's a target.
A judge blocked a ruling that stripped the star of his eligibility.
He's a rookie.
I think I know how to play the game of basketball. I don't change my game when I'm playing against anyone.
He's a millionaire. He's got the life. LeBron James, The Life, an exclusive look inside his world, 8 p.m. Tuesday on ESPN.
It's The Life.
We build it to withstand earthquakes, the elements, anything you can imagine.
At Toyota, we build to withstand the things you can't imagine.
The Tundra was given the highest overall safety rating for full-size pickups by the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety. The Toyota Tundra, better from the ground up.
Taco Bell's new chicken enchilada bowl. Grilled all-white meat chicken, seasoned rice and beans, a traditional slow-simmered sauce, and three cheeses all melting together. To experience enchilada nirvana, you've got to think outside the bun.
Nice four.
Yeah, hey, do they even play softball in Canada?
Oh, boy. I guess I'll be getting that one. Better take a peace offering. Oh, hi. Yeah, I thought we could discuss your new window over some Labatt Blue.
Well, since you put it that way, that's my roommate.
Hello.
Look up, see blue, Labatt Blue.
That guy must have been really mad.
Welcome back to the Gaylord Entertainment Center here in Nashville, Tennessee. Our coverage of the 2003 entry draft winding down is the first round. Winds down here. Welcome back. I'm Dave Strader, and it's been an exciting day here, as it usually is with the NHL draft. It began with the number one overall pick, property of the Florida Panthers. It was traded by general manager Rick Dudley. Really not a surprise. This is something that Dudley has done three times in the last 5 years, trading the first overall pick. It was traded to Pittsburgh, and again, it was not a surprise when they went with Marc-Andre Fleury in a draft considered very deep with no clear-cut number one overall pick. There was a clear-cut number one goaltender. Marc-Andre Fleury was the guy, and that's who Craig Patrick was able to get. So let's take a look at the other picks leading up to number seven in the first round. Eric Staal, projected first overall in most scouting services, went to Carolina. Nathan Horton to the Florida Panthers with that third overall pick. Nikolai Zierdev to the Columbus Blue Jackets. Thomas Vanek to Buffalo. Milan Mikhailuk to San Jose. And Ryan Suter to Nashville. The only down news today, the passing of Roger Neilson to the Ottawa Senators, who they honored earlier with a moment of silence. And they're getting ready to make their selection. We'll be back to wrap up our coverage of the entry draft right after this.
Can a person using a walkie-talkie in Los Angeles instantly contact another in New York?
Homing pigeons, flocks of our feathered friends, tirelessly flying from one coast to the other, outfitted with leg band transmitters and tracked from rooftop data centers.
To create an airborne network that makes transcontinental walkie-talkie signals possible.
No, that's not how we did it. Introducing Nextel's coast-to-coast walkie-talkie. Now that's a walkie-talkie.
If the last thing you want to do is get married,
welcome to the family. You can call me Pussy now.
Pussy?
You know, like a cat.
Then bring home Just Married on DVD for your girlfriend. Just Married. Own the DVD or rip the video today.
Hi, Mom. It's Pee-wee.
Say hi to Pussy for me.
Going to full 12 rounds is all about stamina. That's why I like high endurance from Old Spice. No deodorant protects better. And it lasts longer because it evaporates more slowly. Want proof? If you're not convinced, Old Spice will buy you a stick of your old stuff. Let me put it this way. High endurance will last longer than I do. But I'm working on that.
And start your day with new body wash and body spray from Old Spice. Spice things up.
Welcome back to Nashville. A reminder that ESPN's coverage of the 57th Annual College World Series from Omaha, Nebraska continues tonight with Game 1 of the inaugural championship series. It'll be Stanford taking on Rice in the best of three championship live at 7 Eastern. The College World Series on ESPN, also available on ESPN HD. Call 1-800-DIRECTV or your cable operator to get ESPN HD. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. Well, the Ottawa Senators have just made their selection as we get down near the end of the first round. Patrick Eaves, that is John Muckler on the left, congratulating his number one pick in the draft this year. It's been an exciting day. As I mentioned, the number one pick overall traded by the Florida Panthers, and the Stanley Cup champion New Jersey Devils able to move up and draft 16th. That's Marc-Andre Fleury. He went first overall. Then it was Eric Staal to the Carolina Hurricanes. Nathan Horton, a big, strong center iceman, going to the Florida Panthers. And you see Lou Lamoriello, he made another great pick as well. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. For the entire crew here in Nashville, I'm Dave Strader. Stay tuned next for MLS Soccer as the LA Galaxy kick it off against New York.
From the land of sun, glitz, and Hollywood come the Galaxy. Team LA has the box office stars. The ultimate soccer theater and the jewel every MLS side craves. Across the country in Lady Liberty's shadow lie the Metro Stars. The Big Apple boys have used Broadway theatrics and Wall Street savvy to become a cup contender. Today, it's an East Coast, West Coast battle, MLS style.
Welcome to Radio Shack presents MLS Soccer Saturday. Today, with a victory, the Metro Stars will reclaim the top spot in all of Major League Soccer. Their opposition, the LA Galaxy, unbeaten in their last three, seeking to continue their rise up the Western Conference standings. Glad you're with us from a very soggy Meadowlands. Alongside Ty Keogh, I'm Rob Stone. Things started off rather challenging for the defending champs from Los Angeles. Eight games in a row on the road, scoring just five goals, but in their last three outings, they found net five times. Seems like their offense starting to click. Who do we credit?
Well, when you talk to coaches around the league about the LA Galaxy, they say this is Kobe Jones's team. He wears the armband. Also, he's the catalyst for their attacks. But with him, Mauricio Cienfuegos, the experienced, creative playmaker who's in his final season in MLS at the age of 35. Here's Cienfuegos making this ball out of the corner to find Kobe Jones. Tremendous finish, and the creativity of these two in the attacking midfield for the LA Galaxy is critical.
And while those two are really getting it done offensively lately, Kevin Hartman has been on top of his game all season. Last Saturday, he denied Preki from the spot to ensure a vital 3 points for the defending champs.
No matter where you are, with Sprint wireless phones from Radio Shack, you can take and send pictures instantly. Not that I'm going Hollywood or anything. So come to Radio Shack, your wireless phone headquarters.
Isn't that bad?
Get PCS Vision Picture Phone with Picture Mail that talks from Sprint. Take and send pictures with a recorded message, just $99.99.
I knew it was him.
It was him.
Not that I'm going Hollywood or anything.
Radio Shack.
You know I like you, and I like you a lot. I like Janice a lot, too, and I know she's your roommate.
Janice?
I'm not sure how to say this to you.
You know that I like you a lot, right?
Yeah.
It's just that I like Janice a lot, too, and I know she's your roommate, and I would...
So date both of us.
What? What did you say?
Attention all smokers. Now you can kick the habit in only 7 days guaranteed with Smoke Away, the natural doctor-recommended stop smoking system that really works.
I quit smoking in 2 days with Smoke Away.
It took me 3 days to quit smoking.
I quit smoking the very first day.
The secret is Smoke Away's unique blend of ingredients that helps to almost completely eliminate your craving for nicotine. Imagine, no more nic fits.
It's safe. It's highly effective. I've had tremendous success with my patients using the Smoke Away program.
I was on the patch for 5 months with absolutely no results. I did Smoke Away for 3 days, and I've been smoke-free ever since.
I smoked for 40 years, and I quit in 3 days with Smoke Away. And if I can do it, after trying every other method there is, I know Smoke Away will work for anyone.
Smoke Away is the best product on the market today for quitting smoking.
Call right now and get $50 in free bonus gifts. This is a limited time offer not available in stores. Call right now.
Radio Shack presents MLS Soccer Saturday. Back with you from a very soggy Giant Stadium. Last week, this Metro Stars team lost 3-2 at home to Chicago. They created their chances, Eric Winalda, but finishing them, that was a different story.
You know, a lot of people made a big deal about them getting scored on three times, but the irony is they did have chances to score. They could have been very much in this game. And you know what? Mike McGee had two great headers in the first, you know, the first part of the game and in the second half. These are goals you got to score. These are things that you got to be able to do, and he didn't do a very good job of that. Eddie Gavin. Now remember people, these kids are teenagers, so there might be a little nerves involved here, but definitely not the best in front of the net last week. Big reason why they did not score. You can get away with that in college, but this is not college, people. This is Major League Soccer.
And those youngsters will need the continued assistance of Honduran international Amado Guevara as well. El Lobo, the Wolf, went for a goal and assist last week. We're back with the kick in 60 seconds.
totally new and surprising 2003 Accord sedan from Honda. When was the last time a car sounded this good?
ESPN2's presentation of Major League Soccer is brought to you by Radio Shack. You've got questions, we've got answers. Budweiser, the best things in life are the things that are true. Budweiser and Pepsi Cola, experience the joy of Pepsi. Welcome back. Here's a look at your starting netminders. Kevin Hartman on the left, fourth in MLS with a 1.04 goals against average. And for the Metro Stars, with Tim Howard away with the U.S. national team, Paul Grafer makes his second consecutive start after giving up three goals last Saturday versus Chicago. Metro Stars in the black and the red going right to left. The defending champs from L.A. in the white going left to right. We are underway. Otto Guevara, the main man for the Metro Stars, to the captain, Richie Williams, sends it back. Juan Forchetti, the Argentine, making a start today. We'd like to thank Pepsi and all of our Major League Soccer sponsors for allowing us to bring you today's game without interruption. Paul Grafer having to settle a slick ball and drive it to midfield. Greg Zadie, Mark Lisi chips it, looking for Wallenet. Alexi Wallace is fouled by him, and we start looking at lineups with L.A., 3-5-2 today.
Alexi Lalas, who just hit the carpet here at Giant Stadium, the middleman of that back three in the 3-5-2 for the L.A. Galaxy. Tyrone Marshall on the right, Lewis on the left. A crowded midfield for the L.A. Galaxy, but creativity coming from Jones and Cienfuegos, as we mentioned, with Victorine doing some of the dirty work. Chris Albright and Alex Pineda Chacon will be playing as a withdrawn forward underneath Albright.
No Carlos Ruiz in the starting 11 for the LA Galaxy. He won't be there for at least another game. Fined and suspended earlier this week. We'll have more on that in a moment.
Well, obviously his teammates are a little upset about it. You can actually see on Kobe Jones's armband as the captain, the number 20. I think that's in support of Carlos and his decision to suspend him. I think they're a little unhappy about it.
Joey D.G. Marino, little step by Ezra Hendrickson. We play on, dummy by Richie Williams, and Alexi Lalas drills it right to Mark Lisi. And now Mauricio Cienfuegos. Sasha Victorine had a goal Wednesday. L.A. tied San Jose at home 1-1. Lisi head up, service. Kevin Hartman has it. And we look at the starting 11 for your Metro Stars.
The Metro Stars in a 4-4-2. Paul Grafer in goal. There's been a change at the back. Forchetti has come in where Kenny Arena played last week. D.G. Marino, who's been fighting a groin injury, he's willing to give it a go. Steve Jolly, the experience of that back four. In the midfield, Guevara is the go-to guy for the Metro Stars. We talked to Bob Bradley, their coach. He's the one that has to create the scoring chances. Ricardo Clark will sneak up there as well. John Wolinek and Mike McGee, the front runners.
Bob Bradley with two changes to his starting lineup from last Saturday's game. And there is a good look at the man who's won more games than any other MLS head coach in history, 87 games. There's Richie Williams, captain armband finds Guevara, slides it through. Wallenek is onside. One time to Kevin Hartman is there.